You are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh Jesus, take me. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. And oh God, you are my God. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh Jesus, take me. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh Jesus, take me. Mold and I yield my life to you. higher. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me. Mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you.
take me, more than make me. I yield my life to you. Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Sing it with me. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all that I desire.
Sovereign, full of grace, full of truth, full of mercy, everlasting, forever faithful, forever glorious. Oh, forever you are my God. You are my God, the one and only true God, the Most High, the faithful and true. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire. Almighty Father, oh God. You are my God. Only you in the realms of heaven. Only the realms of glory, oh God, with you forever. Oh God, you are my God. You are all I want, and all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all that I desire. Oh God. You are my God. You're all I want. All that I desire.
Jesus, take me. Oh, that may be. Oh, God.
King of glory, King of majesty, we bow before you now and adore you. King of glory, King of majesty, we bow before you now. King of glory, King of majesty, we bow before you now. King of glory, King of majesty, we bow before you. Thank you.
this is the atmosphere that God wants us to live in. This is what we're supposed to be living in, His presence right now. He wants us to let go of everything that we have, anything that we are holding on to, and just give it to Him and worship Him no matter what. No matter how you're feeling, no matter any circumstances, give it to Him. This is His presence. Feel His presence. He wants to touch you.
To see your will be done throughout this earth. Find in us a people who uncompromisingly stand for you. To see your will be done throughout this earth. Find in us a people who uncompromisingly stand for you. To see your will.
Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all that I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all that I desire. So wonderful living in the presence of the Lord and walking with Him, and hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You can just have a seat. Let me talk to you a bit. Thank you, Jesus. You know, if you would take and put together an idea of what your life would be like if you could do anything that you wanted to do, if you could be anything that you wanted to be, if you could have anything that you wanted to have. I'm going to tell you right now, mine would be big. I'm not talking about thinking of it in terms of all that Father has for us. Not right now. I'm just talking about right in this life. Mine would be huge. Mine would be huge. I promise you. Maybe not a little small vision over here. Maybe a little small plan. I'll just give me a little, you know, just give me a little cabin in the corner of some little obscure place. And nothing like that happened in my life. And so, you know, I need to make sure that everybody's on the same page with me here. I mean, if you get real, I mean, if you really get real for just a moment, you're just free to dream. Go back to when the last time it was you dreamed. Because a lot of times people's dreams end up in the valley of very dry bones. You know, and the Lord's asking you, can these dry bones live? Hallelujah. I mean, people can quit dreaming. They get stuck in their little whatever, and all their expectations were, you know, not realized. I'm going to tell you right now, people, your dream ends when you stop dreaming. And Father has given to us something that goes beyond the framework of those things that we could anticipate or dream or have vision for or describe for ourselves. It's so far beyond that. So far beyond that. So far beyond that. He's got an opportunity for us to where that we walk in such joy, nothing can make us any happier. Hey, I'm gonna tell you right now, when you begin to sing this song, when you know the Lord gave me that song prophetically when I was praying for Brittany the other night. It says expressing the cry of our hearts. That's who we are. That's why we don't go after the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes. That's why we're not impressed by the people of this world. That's why we're not playing. That's why we're not basically just being led about by every little thing. I'm being led by Father, and he's basically walking in an entirely different way than everybody else. I mean, you think about what he wants, what he's got for us, what he's purposed for us. If we just start talking about the things like joy unspeakable and full of glory, if we just start talking about peace that passes understanding, which are things that we become familiar with by description, so much so that we maybe have lost the value of it. Peace that passes understanding. You can't be tempted. I mean, you can be tempted, but you're not going to go for it. When you have peace that passes understanding, come on. When you've got love that goes beyond all knowledge and you're able then to look in and see all the fullness of God, I mean, you're going to be tempted, but you're not going to go for it. I mean, you're not going to be tempted in the sense that, like I like to consider it with respect to where most people are, it's their knee-jerk reaction to go ahead and follow through. Because they don't know anything different. All they know is what they see with their eyes, hear with the ear, taste with their taste buds, smell with their nose, handle with their fingers. All they know how to do is look at somebody else over there looking like they're having a good time as they're playing, interacting with demons, and they think that they want to go do that too because they know nothing about this. True. And we spend a lot of time just trying to express it, and I don't do a good job. I want to do a good job, but I don't. It's inadequate. I'm inadequate to describe the love of God and the person of God. I'm inadequate to even begin to describe His mercy, His goodness, His grace, His light. Totally inadequate. It takes God the Holy Ghost and a willing heart to receive. And if there's anything I want to do is I want to be able to speak on His behalf more plainly, more perfectly, more accurately. Got to live it first. Got to live it first. Just got to live it first. You can't describe in God what you've never lived. And what you've never lived, you don't really know. But that didn't prevent you from falling down on your knees and crying out, "Oh God, please, I want to know you. I'm going to understand how to start walking in holiness and purity. I'm going to understand how to start walking in humility and brokenness. I'm going to learn how." I mean, it takes us so long to get, you know, to quit being so infatuated with ourselves, so captivated with ourselves, so we can begin to take a look at who He is. He's so wonderful. So amazing. I mean, if you just take just those things, love, joy, peace, that's huge. But then he tells us that all that he has, he's given to us freely. Then he tells us whatever we ask him, he will do. Then he tells us that we can say to mountains, be removed out of the way, and they'll obey us. He tells us that there is absolutely nothing impossible for us, that he's given to us a place with him in his own realms of glory and divine authority and divine power. That he's given us the uttermost parts of the earth for our possession, the lost for our inheritance, and all authority over demon spirits to cast them out. Everything in the realm of the spiritual has to obey us.
Amen.
Angels that come to minister for us, to serve us, to run our errands.
Hallelujah.
Ah.
Hallelujah.
No. And it's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. It's not living in sorrow. It's not living in pain. It's not living in affliction. It's not living in torment. It's not living in sickness. It's not living in disease. It's not living in aggravation. It's not living in strife. It's not living in stress. It's not living in the argument. And that is so base. That is so base. Just like in the decision-making category. It's so base. What he is and what he's given to us and what he wants for us is so beyond all of that. People are still trying to decide whether they're going to be happy or not, whether they're going to argue or not. Still thinking that somehow that they've got to live in pain and suffering and sorrow all day long, and they're all upset because they tell them that they don't. Your pain and your sorrow and your suffering comes from the choices that you make. If you don't learn how to make right choices, they're going to get a whole lot worse. God in his love and his mercy, I mean, he's so good to us. He's so good to us. You know, when I behold his glory, I'm going to tell you right now, when I behold his glory, when I'm captivated in that realm of his presence, I feel so undone. The only thing that brings me around is the blood and his righteousness. That's it. That's all. If I even all look at myself, I feel so undone. If I let all look into my achievements and what I've accomplished and who I am and what I know and how sincere and how pure I am, I'm just all undone. And I just run to the blood. I run to the gift.
Amen.
And I just thank him because he's my perfecter. He's perfected everything. He's my perfecter.
Amen.
He's my perfecter.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The only thing that makes you sorrowful is because you want something in this world that you're not supposed to have. You're trying to get something you're not supposed to even have. You know, Father is preparing us unto every good work. Huh? And the reality of it is, not many people are participating with this preparation. They want it their way. You know, God divides individually to each person according to his will. And he wants the exploits of the life or the miracle power of Jesus to be manifested through us. And we're going to have to recognize that we're able to function in all that we're willing to participate with. That's it. And he talks to us about change, and we're threatened by it. We should be excited about it. We should be like, oh yeah, oh yes, yeah, yes. I'm on my destiny. Let not your heart be troubled. All the things that Father has said, all the things that he's promised, and all the things that are done, that he's done, it's already finished. You're not going to be healed. You already were healed.
Amen.
Hold up. You've got to yield to it. You're not waiting to be blessed with all spiritual blessings. You already are. But you've got to learn how to yield to it. And doing your own thing ain't going to help you at all. Going in your own way isn't going to facilitate or in any way allow you to receive what God is flooding us with. We don't know how to walk in it. And so tonight I just want to talk to you about walking in it. I want to talk to you about the things that I've learned. I want to talk to you about who we are and what God the Holy Spirit is saying. You know, when I was praying over you the other night and I began to sing this song prophetically, you know what was going on? I'm going to tell you what was going on because I know what was going on. the Lord was expressing the cry of the Spirit of God on the inside of you, and you need to quit listening to all the other voices and just listen to Him. Because that's what the Spirit of the Lord is saying on this side of you. Oh God, You are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Take me, Jesus. I mean, that's what's going on inside. That's what's going on inside of us. And we're not listening to the right voice. We're not listening to the right inspiration. We get our eyes set on other things. We get our thoughts set on maybe even comparisons or unrealized expectations or things that we may have been dreaming but that didn't seem to come to pass. It doesn't seem like it's all working out. And you've got to recognize, wait a minute, God's almighty. And you need to fall down and worship Him. There's nobody who can prevent His will. Not even you. As long as you're saying, oh God, I want to participate with You, you're not going to prevent His will. You might be on a slow track to growth and maturity. You with me? But He's not going to let up on doing everything He can get us to smut. He's going to do everything in heaven to get us to be happy for a 24-hour period. Say, wow, did you like that? I know it took 50 years, but now, how did you like that? When it could have been the first day. And every day from there, we could have allowed that to grow and that to mature just because we're going to listen to the right voice. We're going to hear His word. We're going to be under His divine unction. Unction is inspiration. We have an unction from the Holy One. We have an inspiration from God and know all things. That's a mind blower. You don't know anything if you're not responding to the inspiration. You don't know anything if you're not walking in the unction. And too many of our own voices and our own ideas, and we think that we know how life works, and it doesn't. We don't. Life works by God the Holy Ghost. God the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And He's a real genuine person, and I'm telling you right now, He's here right now, and He's really big. He's a very big God. He's not some little midget walking around. He's a big, big God. Hallelujah. And he has all power. And his affections are towards us. His designs and His plans for us are huge. And He's just trying to get our attention and saying, would you please quit doing that human stinking thing? Would you please quit thinking that way, acting that way, looking that way? And He does it in so many different ways. He uses people like me. Huh? He'll use a donkey, like trying to prevent the madness of the prophet with a donkey. He'll use whatever is available. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You're here tonight because you want what God's placed in my mouth.
Amen.
You're here tonight because you want to understand how to get in the midst of a place of brokenness before God, a place of submission towards God where all the false motives and all the wrong thinking and all the wrong ideas and all the religiosity is completely removed, excised from your life. So that you can step forward into these works and greater works so that Father can do what He wants to do. And what He wants to do is He wants to glorify His only begotten Son. He wants to reveal Jesus. He wants to prove that redemption and the miracle of salvation reproduces Jesus Christ, the living God, incarnated in flesh in everyone who's willing to believe.
Amen.
Same power, same authority, same grace, same glory, same baptism, same anointing, same life, same ministry, same power, same position, same eternity. To sit down with Him in His throne, even as He sat down with the Father in His throne, is the summation of it all. To understand that there is going to be one gigantic camp meeting one day, and it's called the marriage supper of the Lamb, and Jesus Christ Himself is the one who's serving dinner. I promise you that when we go to preachers' camp meetings, that it isn't the preachers up serving the dinner with an apron on. I promise you. They're sitting around the table and the others are serving. Jesus says, you're going to sit down, and he's going to take his towel and his servant's cloth in hand, and he's going to wait tables on you and me. Maya Shitolo Bokipa. He gave to us his own body for food, his own blood for drink. My. You know what happens when you quit standing up for things and start laying down your life for things? You begin in God. What's happening is God has to spend all this life, all of our life, working with us to quit us, to try to get us to stop standing up for stuff and to start laying down our lives for people, to start walking in love and being clothed in humility and masikara, to quit championing our own ideas. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, God, the Holy Spirit will never inspire anything on the inside of you that will cause you to argue with other people. That wasn't God's inspiration. No, God will inspire things on the inside of you that will teach you and cause you how to love people, how to lay down your life for people. God, the Holy Spirit will never inspire an accusation or a finger pointing of somebody's faults. He'll never do it. It's another realm that's an accuser. Amen. And yet, many of God's people have never learned even how to understand the voice of the Spirit, the voice of the living God, even on the very basic introductory level. How then will we ever hear him say those things that are in his heart to reveal to us and declare to us? It's time, people. It's time that we just grab a hold of Nasito Romongia Tisananea, the purpose of the Stebremonde, the purpose of the Spalletos Dai, the tongues, the language of the Spirit, to teach us how to talk like God, to teach us how to praise, to teach us how. Holy Spirit, I love that song. I just thank you so much, Joshua, and the rest of you for taking some of those prophetic songs and singing them, because they're from heaven. You know, they're from heaven. They're not from me. They're from heaven. I lay no claims to them. Somebody said, don't you need to copyright them? No, it's public domain. You know, I don't care. It belongs to God. You know, it's his. My, you know, just the Holy Spirit, take my life. Place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. I mean, come on. There's got to be a relationship that causes something to explode in our heart of the very cries of the Spirit of the Son, of the inspirations of the Holy One, instead of sitting around filled with our own ideas, filled with our own thoughts, filled with our own opinions, filled with our own self-worth. Just shutting all that down. So you can be here. You can hear the still small voice. Most of us, it takes an earthquake for us to say, oh, what just happened? Oh, something happened? It takes a wind that explodes the rock for us to notice that something's going on. Wow! Still small voices? Who hears those? You hear me? The gentleness of God, divine inspirations, his unction, and we just get still. We got all these things imposing themselves upon us, and we just lay them all aside.
Yes.
Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Now you can begin to hear. Because all these other things are trying to vie for your affections, vie for your emotion, vie for your attention, vie for your passion, vie for your purpose. No! I was made for heaven.
Amen.
The day that I was born again.
Amen.
I was a gift that Father presented to the Lord Jesus to say, Son, this is what your work at Calvary has done. It's reproduced yourself in Brittany, in Leslie, in Annalyn, in Raphael, in Manny, in Aaron, in you, in me. Every person. I'm not leaving anybody's name out. I just got to stop somewhere. And somehow we don't recognize that for the wealth and for the honor and for the riches and for the glory that it is. We don't recognize that it's stepping into a realm, stepping in through a door that brings to us an unlimited scale of ability and grace and power, something of God's good pleasure flowing out to us that then results in His presence, His glory, His majesty, His Spirit flooding out of our lives. And oh, wouldn't it be wonderful to go to church where everybody had a flood of the Holy Ghost busting out of them all of the time. Can you imagine being in the, talk about heavenly sunshine. Heavenly sunshine. Talk about showers of blessing. Talk about rain, the latter rain. Talk about a witness of the resurrection. Talk about reality of that which Christ Jesus suffered, bled, and died, and we're barely even willing to smile about it. It's got to change. And you are the one that has to oversee the change. Hallelujah. Because God has commanded it. He's commanded it. And that which He has commanded, He's empowered us to do it. Hallelujah. Tonight, you are going to step into a revelation and how to walk with Him. You are going to step into a revelation of how to serve Him. A revelation of how not to get distracted and all these other things. You don't want them. You don't want them. If it doesn't come from God, you don't want it. If it's wealth that doesn't come from God, you don't want it. If it's honor that doesn't come from God, you don't want it. If it's position that doesn't come from God, you don't want it. If it's happiness that doesn't come from God, you don't want it. If it's joy that doesn't come from, if it's love that doesn't come from God, come on, you don't want it. Because there, and you've got to get serious about this, because there's all kinds of substitutes, there's all kinds of deception going on right now, where Satan, as an angel of light, is presenting all kinds of false truths and false love and false peace and false authority and false position and false honor, so you can get all wrapped up in yourself and miss out on heaven now and throughout the ages. And what a terrible thing. Somebody said, what about all of these good people? I said, well, all of these good people, I'm sorry, they're deceived, and I'm on my face crying out to God, oh Lord, and I need to be on my face more crying out to God, oh, use me to break the deception. How about all of these wonderful people called Mormons? I love them. They're such dear, sweet people that are so deceived. They're just deceived. Are you telling me that they're on their way to an eternity without God as many times as they say Jesus in a given day? I'm telling you, yes, they are. And I'm telling you that they're not the only ones in the epidemic of deception, because many people that go to Christian churches all over America, all over the world, especially the Western world, are just as deceived. They're just as deceived. Somebody said, well, why are they deceived? And then they'll go off into some theological explanation, and then about the Mormons or about this group or that group. And then you just talk about the Christian church. Why are they deceived? Because they say they have the life of God and live like the devil. They say they have the joy of the Lord to chew one another out. They say they have the peace that passes understanding to do nothing more than create strife. They say they lay down their life for the living God, but they're not willing to give anything to the brother in need, especially the spiritual needs. We just want to throw a couple of bucks at it and say, that'll do. That's not what the Lord wants us to give. He wants to give affection and love. I was so blessed. You know, Allie brought somebody to church this morning, and she was just so captivated by the contagion of joy. Hey? Yes. And I say contagion of joy because it's infectious. Hallelujah. 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 Kate brought someone to church recently and said, can people actually have a relationship with Jesus and be happy? Because there's a lot in especially the Middle Eastern countries, and he's from the Middle East, where all you hear is just sorrow and sadness. You don't hear joy and gladness. People haven't stepped into intimacy and unction and inspiration. The floodgates of heaven haven't really been able to be actuated in their life because they've had wrong models and believed wrong things and thought they were supposed to be sorrowful and sad and in pain and sickness. There's people that believe that you're closer to Jesus if you've got a disease. Try to preach that as good news. I'm here to tell you that you're going to really be close to Jesus if you allow him to give you this really, you know, cancerous disease, maybe cancer of the eye. Huh? Leprosy. And we're all going to know that you're walking in the anointing because your both ears are head off, as the country boy said. Jesus. Would you open your Bibles tonight with me to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 5? And tonight I want to just begin to help you understand some things from the Scripture. I want you to understand that pride will destroy you. I want you to understand that every form of pride will destroy you. It will result in your downfall. It will actually strip you of any anointing, any likeness of God. It will strip you of it. You have to decide whether or not you're open for that. I'm going to tell you right now, Satan is the supreme example of rebellion. And everybody who sins are going to turn out just like him. Let me just say that again, just in case you didn't hear me real clearly. Satan is the supreme example of rebellion against God. And everybody who sins is going to turn out just like him. Listen, I want you to understand, all of that began in his haughtiness and his rebellion and his pride and his self-seeking. He wants something for himself. He wants it better for him. He wants to stand up for himself rather than to lay his life down for anything. God, our Father, is absolutely different in every respect. All you can understand him by, Jesus came and revealed him. And it's not anything that we really grasp. And I believe tonight that there are going to be people in here that are going to grasp it. And when you do, you'll understand how to function in a greater anointing. And if you'll fully grasp it, you'll function in the full expression of the divine anointing of the ministry and life of Jesus. And he even promised it'd be greater, but you've got to come into his school. And his school is the school of lowliness and meekness. To grasp the lowliness and meekness of God, the humility and the brokenness of God, that's who he is. That's not who he's requiring us to be, and he's something different. That's who he is. And he's saying, I want you to come into my life, and I want you to learn my life, and I want to show you how beautiful and wonderful it is. I'm going to show you that pride and haughtiness is going to destroy you, and brokenness and subjugation and being a servant and laying down your life instead of standing up for things, instead of being all on the defensive. God is the only one who's allowed to be on the defensive. You and I are not. You get on the defensive, you are of the wrong spirit. Yeah. And it'll strip you of anointing, it'll strip you of life, and whatever it is you were championing is just going to be that much more infected and messed up. True. Because vengeance belongs to God. Defense is his. He's our defense. And he's told us and he's commanded us to not do anything like that. On the highest of levels, if they strike you on the cheek, give to them the other also. Because I'm going to tell you right now, if they get to strike you once, because there's been people and testimonies of people, and I've even had them in my own life where people go to hit you and they can't hit you. People's arms freeze. But if they do get to smack you and you turn the other cheek, I would be just surprised if they were able to actually take the second swing, because God's going to step in. And if they took the second swing, I promise you it probably isn't going to go any further than that. And if it does, still Father's in control. He's going to do something great. Amen. He's going to do something. He's going to come to your aid. He's going to come to your defense. He'd do it speedily. Do it speedily. Hallelujah. As Luke chapter 18 says. So in 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 5 says, likewise, you younger, submit yourself unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subjugated one to another. And when the Lord's talking about subjugation and he's talking about being servants, he's showing us how his ministry functions, how the kingdom of God works. And it's really the great example of it is where he takes a towel and a basin. On the night that he is going to give his life, he's going to give his life blood, he's going to be the ultimate servant of all and die in our stead. And he says, look, here's how it works. This is how you're supposed to minister to one another. I'm going to show you what it means to lay down your life for one another. You're supposed to wash each other's feet. You're supposed to be the slave to each other. People don't even get this. I start talking about this, and we go into, you know, look, you know, in the Jewish culture, one of your Jewish servants was not allowed to be a foot washing servant. You were not allowed to give him that state, that lower state of humiliation. He had to get a Gentile servant to take up that particular role and that duty. But yet here Jesus is doing it, and he's telling us this is what he wants us to do. But if you're not willing to do it, and Father's here tonight trying your hearts, he's trying our hearts, he's saying you're not willing to walk in my anointing. You're not willing to walk in my power. If I give you authority to move mountains, I mean, I'm going to tell you, you're going to kill somebody before you even get home. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If I gave you authority that whatever you asked, it would happen, my goodness, how many people would be dead by the afternoon? There's no way to wield his authority and to wield his power and to move in his divine realms of glory unless you learn how to be the servant of every single person. Unless you learn how to be a slave, a foot-washing slave. And who's, I'm going to tell you right now, it's hard to offend a foot-washing slave. A person so full of love that their biggest image of themselves is that they think that they would make a great servant girl. If you ask them, well, what do you think you would like to do? What do you think you'd be good at? Well, I think I would be really good at washing people's dishes and mopping their floors and doing their laundry. People are going to look around here and go, what? I was thinking more like being queen or like, you know. I was thinking more like of having a dominion and ruling over it. Huh? I was thinking more like about having more servants to take care of my various little needs. Papa wants to train us how to step over into the realms of the anointing, how to move in his majesty, how to move in his glory, how to move in his splendor. And the entrance in is humility. If you want to learn perfect obedience, humility will show you perfect obedience. When you're walking around in humility and you're walking around as a servant in that place of humility, you're no longer making decisions for yourself. Hallelujah. When you're walking around in meekness, you're no longer self-willed. It's about what Father's willed. Now you're in a disposition where you can begin to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, because that's where he's talking. He's talking in a realm of that which all the pride and arrogance and stubbornness and self-willed is so loud, it just absolutely drowns out any possibility of hearing his still small voice. If you're captivated by all the other things that men in this world are captivated by, strong power, authority, dominating, men love a dictator. They all aspire to be one. They only quit liking a dictator when all of a sudden oppression gets so bad that they don't have food and they blame it on the dictator. Stalin proved it again and again. And he's not the only one. There's been too many ruthless tyrants that proved how much men love dictators. How much men demand a king. Demand a monarch. Instead of God. Hello. Tonight, can you just salty my cash to portable tough? Can you just be willing in your relationship with the Lord and begin to cry out to him and say, oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. And in that, allow everything that you hold so dearly, that you value, that you champion for yourself. You know, tonight we were walking in and you know, my wife and I were just joking with each other a little bit. I said, yeah, we need to take those coffee tables to Oregon. She said, yeah, we shouldn't probably take them on the airplane. I said, no, we don't want to do that again. I said, that would really be a big suitcase. And she knew what I was talking about. She said, now, Pastor, we're not taking anything from 216 into 217. I said, you're right. I repent. Father, forgive me. I'm not even supposed to remember, but people are dragging stuff from the time they were 2 years old. And some of them are 80. Can you imagine how many chains you have on you? Can you imagine how many afflictions you have on your soul in the realm of your thinking and the realm of your spirit? that impose itself upon you, that when God speaks, all you can hear is all of these other voices interpreting them on the basis of your own experience, and you never get to hear the sweet purity of His grace and of His call to you to come and have a relationship with Him and be loved by Him, because you got all this, you're all tied up in knots. Well, in the name of Jesus Christ, God begs you and pleads with you to be changed.
Amen.
To be unchained.
Yes.
To come out of your prison. But you know what? I've watched over and again that even though God instantaneously gives us a miraculous change, people with inside of weeks go back to their former conversation and they bring that back along. They start remembering it. They start once again allowing it to be imposed upon them. They start burdening their new heart and their new spirit with all of these things that happened to them in the past. And they bring that old that was destroyed, that former thing that was supposed to be passed away, right along with them in their relationship with the Lord. And it stands as a great gulf between them and God. While they praise Him, while they sing their songs, while they pray their prayers, and then they're not getting answered. So now they've got to come up with new doctrinal ideas in order to be able to explain their experience with God. Instead of humbling themselves before Him and saying, Father, I want to do it Your way. I want to get this right. Oh God, have mercy on me. Father, I'm way too arrogant and boastful and self-reliant. I want to learn how to walk with You. I want to learn how to yield myself to those things that are so beautiful to You, that are so ugly to humanity. So ugly. Lowliness is ugly. Hello. It's not a popular thing to go for, to learn how to walk in humility and brokenness. Meekness is not high on folks' list of what they would like to achieve with their life. What are you really working towards achieving? You're not going to go to any motivational seminars on how to walk in loneliness and meekness. They don't exist. How to be servant, how to let others win. It doesn't exist. How to promote the cause of others, how to esteem others better than yourself. You know, the Lord tells us to esteem everyone better than ourselves. Sometimes I wonder in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, is there anyone you esteem better than yourself? Have you learned anything about brokenness and loneliness? Have you learned anything about being subjugated one to another to become, to understand that Jesus wasn't just passing the time of day with a suggestion when He listened to the pride and the boasting of men as they're walking along talking about who's the greatest? You know, that arrogance. And men, women really get it. Every time He just... If I hear Ann in the kitchen laughing, it's because she just heard Alexander Scorby read that verse of Scripture. Because it's hilarious. And Jesus says, time out, guys. You don't even got a clue. You don't even get it. And He tells us, and He makes it very clear, that the greatest in the kingdom of God are the servants of all. But we don't get it. Because rarely do you find anybody in the context of being baptized in the Holy Ghost and their first reaction is, I'm going to learn how to be servant of all. And I'm going to take this thing to the mat and I'm going to learn how to lay down my life for the household of faith. I'm going to learn how to love the brethren as Christ Jesus loved me. But that's where it all begins. That's the straight and the narrow. That's the entrance in. To be clothed with humility and to walk in this love. And you're not going to walk in this love without being clothed with humility. The Lord says to us, He makes it very, very clear to us here in this verse of Scripture, His response to walking in His humility. And the only thing left is the pride of men. Hello. I want you to understand this. There's nobody getting down on you here tonight. There's nobody saying, you know, pointing the finger of judgment here at you. You know, I'm right here in the same boat with the rest of you, shaking and trembling and fearing for our lives and wondering why Jesus looked like a spook walking on the water. I'm right here in the same boat with you. There is either a humility, the humility of God, or there is some dimension of pride and arrogance. And God in his seat, and we think, well, because this is going on in our life, or that's going on in our life, are we doing this, are we doing that? This somehow, you know, is God's, you know, full token of approval upon our life and our conduct. It's not. It's his mercy and his grace that still deals with us to call us to a place of submission to his ways. He's so faithful. He's so long-suffering. His mercy, his promises, he has just sworn an oath. I mean, come on. Yes, yes. We've been, this covenant has provided us with the blood of Emmanuel, yes, the oath of God, and the seal of the Holy Ghost, with all of our unwillingness to move past day one of the new birth. Hello. Yes. Say, help me, Jesus.
Help me, Jesus.
I want to move beyond day one of the new birth. Now listen, I mean, you're going to have to get bigger about that than just, you know, getting all calisthenic on me. It's got to go deep in your heart. Yes. And Papa knows, and he wants to establish this. And guess what? If you're really serious about this, instead of doing all the calisthenics, you're going to get up and serve somebody in the morning. And you're going to be doing some serving before you go out here tonight. And if everybody makes you, uses you for a doormat and wipes their feet on you, you didn't even notice. You didn't even notice. Oh, I just thought they needed to clean their shoes. I was happy to help. Oh, yeah, it's very exciting until all of a sudden it comes to reality. When reality comes to beckon, and some of you got to go, you got to get blamed for something you didn't do, and you got to die for that which you never involved yourself in. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, would the church shine with the brightness of the noonday sun? Would the glory of the Lord truly be seen upon his people if we would just give ourselves to the fundamental step one, day one of reality of walking in the Spirit and living the life of Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Living this life of God.
Amen.
I pray tonight that you get hungry.
Amen.
You have a troubles with obedience. It's because you don't walk in humility. Because as soon as you do, you start walking in humility as a servant of God, it's going to be no problem for you to let God be your leader. You're going to let Holy Ghost be your leader. And you're going to quit being the leader and quit being in charge. Boastfulness, self-reliance, self-confidence. And every day of your life in a Western world, in a Greco-Roman world, you're taught how to compete, how to be the best, how to dominate. Huh? How that the strong survive and the weak die by the wayside and fall by the wayside. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, when somebody dies, their life just began. You're looking at a very narrow perspective of eternity, a narrow perspective of existence. When all of your judgment is based upon what you can see and what you can understand within the framework of our own individual human perceptions, God's word opens up before us the ability to understand what God is doing. He's God. He's God, your healer, and it's done.
Amen.
I don't care what kind of little instrument they put on you, what kind of, you know, fluttery feelings you may feel. Forget about it. It's done.
Amen.
God's healed you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's all about receiving what he's done.
Amen.
It's about receiving sonship.
Amen.
I mean, come on. If if we understand who Jesus is and how he behaves and how he acts and what he does, and then we say that we receive salvation, we receive sonship, then we should understand that we are fully vesting our life into a reproduction of who we see in Jesus. Because that's the life that God has reproduced, not any other kind of life, but the life of Jesus. His life was as a grain of corn that was sown into the earth, and it reproduced after its own kind. And he reproduced his life in us, and so that we may say, Christ is in me, my confidence of glory. Christ Jesus lives and dwells in here. This life that I have, that I live by the faith of the Son of God.
Amen.
I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not me. Jesus has reproduced his life in me. It's Christ who lives. Now I'm committed to that.
Amen.
I'm committed to it. Not just on the concepts and ideas of what we believe. Because we believe that means that you come to church and you sing a song. And that's not what that means. That's not the reproduction of the life of Jesus. That you occupy your seat. And it wasn't too many years ago that if you gave enough money in the church, your name was engraved on that seat. That's your seat. We haven't really advanced too much other than there's not engravements upon our chairs. Many of you know that there was a time in this church where I just wouldn't allow anybody to sit in the same chair. It's like, you got to move around. You guys got to get used to change. You know, I see people that could always come in and sit in the same chair. Geneva and David have sat in the same chairs for the past 3 months. I mean, come on, give me a break. Find another chair. That's what we do. We fossilize. We do this. We get into these things that are just, it's funny. I want to practice change. I want to teach you change. Change is growth and maturity. When you're not changing, you're either plastic or you're dead. No, dead things change. You're plastic. You're plastic. We don't have any plastic plants. I told them to get rid of it, I hope. Huh? That's not plastic, is it? It's just so much. Here's the most important part. It's just beginning to get real with God. He is not going to play around with pretend or lie. He demands truth. God will only participate with truth. When you say, Lord, I want this. I want what you planned. I want your program. I want to take me, Jesus. Mold me, make me. I yield my life to you. I mean, this is going on in the morning. It's going on tonight here. You come here to understand how you're going to live tomorrow, how you're going to step up and begin to participate with God in a more radical way, because what's imposing itself upon you is all the lies and all the deceptions of a world that is around you that is demon-possessed, demon-created, demon-ruled.
Right.
And if you're not careful, you're going to take on that image because you live with them more than you live with God. You live with that community, the people that you work with, more than you live with the church. And then if we start asking you to come to church more, you're acting like, you know, we're just really imposing on you. If we tell you you need more food, spiritual food, you're acting like somehow we're imposing upon you. But that's not so with breakfast, lunch, and supper. You know, if you're like, oh my goodness, I got to eat breakfast, and I got to get up in the morning, I got to eat breakfast again, and lunch is just right here a few hours after breakfast. My goodness. And then supper just a few hours from there, and you know, and then I've got to have maybe snacks in between. You hungry. You like that. You delight in it. God wants to give us a hunger and a passion for something that's so much better that it's not a legalistic thing that we got to do. It's not a requirement. It's like, I'm hungry. Oh, God, I want to hang out with you. I want to be conformed to your image. I want to learn to be like you, walk like you. And it's not going to happen at work. It's not. You can be an evangelist there. You can begin to show out of your conduct and out of your life what has happened to you in the midst of the church, in the midst of your relationship with the Lord, in the midst of the community of God, where the moving of the Spirit has so radically touched you that it becomes a protection and a defense against all these other things that want to vie for your affections and demand of you to be exactly like it is. And I use it because as far as I'm concerned, demons are just its. They don't qualify for any more than just it. And that's why the Lord had to use the Greek language to describe devils, because Hebrew did not have any its, no neuter in the Hebrew language. You had to get Greeks, you got to get Gentile languages to get its out of it. Huh? Well, there's some more I could say about that, but I'm going to leave it. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Huh? Hallelujah. If I could just grasp the reality that Father is going to have a relationship with those who walk in humility, and he's not going to have any kind of relationship. In fact, this word here, this testimony here in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, the word is just diluted when the King James and some of the other translators translated it, resist. It literally means he will come and make war or fight against the proud. Because you're in the camp of the wicked one. Hello. I mean, if there's anything that you and I should just, it should just cause all the alarms to go off and go, my goodness, if I want to learn how to yield to God, if I want to learn how to receive all that He has given, if I want to learn how to have the kind of intimacy with Him that He has provided for me, it is only going to be in the context of humility. That's why He says His school is lowliness and meekness. He said, all of you guys that are thrashed, you're weary, you're laboring, you're run down, you're heavy laden, come unto me and I'll give you rest. Quit being in charge of your life. Hello. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come here. I'll give you rest. Come and learn of me. I want to reproduce my life in you. I want you to have all that I have. I want you to find life and life more abundantly. I want it to be on the inside of you with expressions that are like floods of God's divine power and glory, floods of the Holy Ghost. I want you to understand it's the school of lowliness and meekness.
Amen.
There's no offense there.
Amen.
Huh? Because you didn't notice that somebody was screaming at you and hollering. You were just like, they were just a little upset. I just wanted to calm them down. Just tell them that it's going to be okay. Because they didn't take anything personal. Can you even imagine that a life and existence without any measurable pride? Without any measurable self-will and self-exaltation? Could you imagine how wonderful it is, how glorious it is, how carefree it is, how that now you won't have any more burdens and you won't be heavy laden anymore and you won't live in unforgiveness anymore and you won't live in bitterness anymore because you're the servant of all. You're just a slave child to Jesus and to everybody around you to fix whatever's wrong with them, to lay down your life so that it's comfortable. What can I do for you? I see that you're upset. Can I help? Are you going to be okay? Let me pray for you.
Thank you.
Can I get you something? Can I do something for you? Ooh. And that's just the elementary level of it. It goes deeper. Hang around my wife. You'll understand what it means to be a servant of all. You'll learn it. You'll learn what it means to be happy, to walk in love. Why is she so happy? Because she's such a servant. Why does she walk in such love? Because she's such a servant. Ask anybody who knows her. She's the real deal. I hear it all over the world. She's the real deal. People look at her from far away. Preachers look at my wife from far away and go, wow, she's the real deal. I take her with me because she makes me look so good. It's like sometimes my motivation of opening the door and getting her to go in first when I'm going to a meeting is because I want the first impression. I'm with her. We were sitting on the front row and, you know, in a prestigious place with prestigious ministers and, you know, in an event and you know, people were coming to me going, your wife is an amazing woman. And she didn't do anything. She just sits there in the meeting. They watched her conduct, her behavior. People who have authority, people who know, because there's people of authority, people with very large churches, very prestigious situations. They know. They got an eye to see when people are disgruntled and unhappy and hard to live with. Did you know that? The pastors know it. They got you. And even people in authority, CEOs, people who are trained, you know, people, heads of human resources, kind of, They know. You get to a place where you can really spot unhappy, disgruntled people. And it's terrible when they come to church and wonder if there's anybody that's, you know, saved. God's called us to come and shine. He says, arise and shine, for your light has come. Yes. What does that look like? It looks like the life of Jesus. Yes. Why aren't we infatuated with that? Why isn't that bigger to us than all the other models? Why isn't that? And if we're really infatuated with it, that means that we are going to want to live just like Him and do just what He does. If we really think you're amazing, I want to be just like you. And then on top of that, you may think that some Hollywood star or some famous person is who you want to be like, you know, Bill Gates. But I'm going to tell you right now, you're never going to be him. As much as you want to, you're never going to be him. And that's usually the way it is for human beings. When they want to be somebody, they want to emulate someone, they want to talk like someone, they want to act like someone. They don't have the ability. They don't have what it takes, you know, fundamentally from their genetics to be that. But when we want to be like Jesus, when we want to conform to Him, when we want to do what it is He does, we're invested in do with all divine power to be that. Wow! Can somebody else go, wow, besides me? Are you, come on, wow. He's amazing.
Yes.
I know that you can be, you might be silent because it just, you're so, it's so aloof from you. Because the more real it becomes to you, the more you're going to scream, wow. I promise you. Because I've been where you're at, and I'm where I'm at now. And I'm so desperate to be like him. Hello, come on, people. Somebody said, you know, we're all a bunch of lookalikes. We are. We're a bunch of act-alikes, too. I know exactly what you're going through, because I probably went through it, too. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Jesus knows exactly what we're going through, because he went through it, too. I basically look around, and I see about 12 personalities of people. That's it. Modeled by 12 apostles. You notice how you go? I mean, we found Joseph Deskin in Oregon. There's Joseph. Acts just like him, sits like him, thinks like him, behavior, everything like him. I found Joseph Deskins all over the world. I found Leslie Faulkner's all over the place. Brittany's all over the place. Yeah, I promise you. Come on, why don't we just turn away from all of that and start, so when we find Jesus all over the place, wouldn't that be amazing? Our personality takes on him. We are, you get your voice sounding just like him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I've seen people who admire preachers and they try to sound just like the preacher. They try to walk like the preacher. And it's funny, they imitate the preacher down to the very, very detail of how he holds his hands. I know one guy who holds his hands like this. I got all these preachers that are doing the same thing. It's pretty funny. I mean, you know, that's kind of admirable in some respects to have that kind of honor for a man of God. But how about when we got that kind of honor for Father?
Yes.
How about when we recognize, wait a minute, you don't even get to even participate until you're willing to learn how to let the Holy Spirit fill you with humility and lowliness and meekness that is fundamental to the witness and the testimony that you're walking in the Holy Spirit, that you have Christ Jesus formed on the inside of you, and all of a sudden it changes your admiration and the profile of your admiration about things around you. Just to get it to the point to recognize, wait a minute, Father doesn't have nothing to do with people who walk around all arrogant, self-reliant, proud, boastful. And most people don't think that they're arrogant, self-reliant, proud, and boastful. But it's either the humility of Christ or that. Hello. I know everybody wants not light nor darkness but shadows, not love nor hate but kind of like. But those things don't even exist. They're not even real. They're make-believe. It's lie or truth. It is. It's just a lie or it's the truth. It's light or it's darkness. It's God or it's Satan. It's pride or it's humility. And the Lord's going to show us over and again. And I'm just going to give you a few verses of scripture, get you hot on the trail of pursuing these things in God, to show you that it's pride that creates your destruction, your downfall, your shame, your ruin. It's pride that creates us the inability to even succeed, especially in relationship. Oh, mamá, se te romo gate lia pasata. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're going to walk out of this with, I mean, you're going to walk out of here with us tonight. The people who have stepped into the greatest of anointings are the people who gave themselves 100% over to humility and brokenness. Catherine Coleman is a great example of that. Mariah Woodworth Etter is a great example of that. She, everywhere she went, preachers ridiculed her. They mocked her. They berated her because it's not right for a woman to stand and preach and teach a man. I mean, they laid her out right, left, and center. God had a call upon her and everybody told her she could not preach. It wasn't until all of a sudden a couple of men of God came around her and saw the gifting of God upon her life. And then she and was there to be support for her. And everybody, you name them, Smith Wigglesworth, the Bosworth, F.F. Bosworth, the Ritchie brothers, you name whoever you want to name. John G. Lake, all of them, they said there was no one who functioned and flowed and operated in the miracle power of the Holy Ghost and the ministry of Jesus like Mariah Woodworth Etter. Where does all of that came from? It was found in her place of being broken and being willing to be a servant. It's so much easier for women to learn how to walk in humility usually because they're used to serving already. Men, it's very difficult because everything about your culture, especially in a Western society, has made you prideful, boastful, arrogant, self-reliant. Everybody's got to be serving you. And listen to what you got to say. because you're the king of your own universe. And this has got to be broken down. Everybody who's ever stepped into a miracle ministry, a great miracle ministry, they had something in common. There was great humility and brokenness in their life. And as soon as the humility and brokenness stopped, their miracle ministry stopped. I was hearing Ed DuBois talk about a guy that he knew, a great man of God that he knew. And he was just talking about how you have to protect anointing in your life. And he's saying, this guy was amazing. God gave him x-ray vision. He could look into a person's life. He could actually see the cancer. He could see the disease. He could see the organ. He would speak to it. And everybody got healed that he did that with. He could see it. And he was going to minister at a university on the supernatural. Those things superior to the natural realm. And he didn't speak English. He was getting ready to tell somebody that he needed an interpreter. And he's just getting ready to ask for an interpreter. All of a sudden, he's speaking English. Wow. Just such great miracle ministry. He raised so many people from the dead. And then all of a sudden, he found himself in context with other people, competition context. And, you know, other people are getting, you know, the opportunities are being deferred to them. And he's asking questions like, well, how many people have they raised from the dead? Because I've raised more people from the dead than any of them. All of them put together. And he lost the miracle realm. The greatness of the power, display of the life of Jesus Christ was no longer in existence because he went off. Now he lost his place of brokenness and crying out to God and neediness as a servant. Come on, people, this is true. These things happen all the time. I've lived with people who've done great things, signs and wonders and miracles. I mean, where everybody in the deaf section heard, everybody in the blind section saw. I'm not kidding you. Who were with Benson Idahosa in the early days and say, there was no man of greater authority than Benson Idahosa. When Benson Idahosa, and I don't mean to say this in a derogatory way, I'm just trying to give it an example. I shouldn't even be using a name right now. But just bear with me. And Benson, if you're listening, just bear with me. Understand this. There was nobody with greater authority. When he would speak, I mean, great signs and wonders, whatever he said would happen. But then there was a transition where all of a sudden it became more than just a simple servant in the house. Huh? It's happened to so many people where they become doctor, reverend, archbishop. So-and-so. And now the titles have replaced. I mean, I remember a dear friend saying, I used to have the angel of the Lord with me. I used to have the angel of the Lord with me. I remember one friend of mine, he's gone now. Because I had to be, everybody told me I had to learn how to be respectable and decent because I was too much of a wild man for them. But now the angel's gone. Now that I'm respectable and decent and give 3-point sermons, he's gone. I remember hearing one dear friend of mine talk to a brother about who always had the angel of the Lord with him. He said, the angel is gone. I've not seen the angel for many years. He said, I traded the angel for my own ministry. And the man of God that I know is a friend of mine was talking to this other man of God that was always a hero of mine and said, just start talking about the angel again. Just be willing to humble yourself and go back there to that place. But how do you find yourself back there? Because now this is how you make your money. And if you change your style, the people aren't going to want you back in the meetings. And you live by the itinerant ministry. It's pretty bad, ain't it?
Yeah.
My daddy used to tell me, he said, listen, if you got to pull rabbits out of the hat for people to come to the meeting, he said, you'll have to pull rabbits out of the hat for the rest of your life. So decide right now whether you're going to be a magician or a minister. I said, I'm going to go and be a minister. if the anointing, if the word of God doesn't attract people, I don't want it. I mean, I know it's kind of hard to climb over top of my drama. But look at Catherine's drama. Catherine, when I was a little guy, she scared me. The Holy Spirit is here. She scared me. It was weird. But all the miracles will eclipse all the weirdness, won't it? Hallelujah. Yeah. I tell the Lord all the time, Lord, unless you grant miracles for me, my weirdness is my downfall. Lord, the only way that people are going to be able to tolerate me is that your signs and your wonders and your miracles are extraordinary in my life. Show me what I got to do. And Father's always talking to me about humility and brokenness and letting him be the leader and quit being self-reliant. The Lord talked to me about one time in my life, he just kept saying to me, get out of the way. Get out of the way. I said, Lord, use me. Oh, God, use me. It was in the mid-90s, you know, and it was a great transition in our life. I mean, I lived in the prayer room. I could just see the fire of God upon every house, and it was right where Father was getting me prepared to sound a trumpet in the city and see more than 160 churches come together to do, you know, mass meetings for a little over 5 years in San Diego. And, you know, I just there in that place, in that crucible before the Lord, just crying out to Father, oh, Lord God, show me how to step into this realm of being sensitive to you. And he just simply say, get out of the way. I'm like, what does that even mean? I am so clueless. What does that even mean? You're self-reliant. You're haughty. You're doing it your own way. You're walking in your own understanding. It's nothing more than boastful pride. Oh, that. By the way, I don't want that in my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. If we get ourselves in this situation, Lord, why? Why is it that, I've asked the Lord, why is it that I have to be so humbled? Why? Why? And the Lord reminds me, because you asked me for your fire. You told me over and again you wanted only my way, not your way. You didn't want some kind of half ministry. You wanted the full ministry. You didn't want a shortcut. You wanted the whole cut. You're going to get what you pray for with God. I've had it over and over and over and over again, man, where I had Carlos, my dear friend Carlos, had a condo and I had him doing, we had a 10-acre place and he was doing a 10 nights of meetings for us. And, you know, we had this huge stage, you know, huge stage. Stage was as big as this room practically, a little smaller. But it's huge stage, 5,000 seats out there. You remember having to run the sound and everything. And, you know, I knew on the Sunday, because 10 days takes in a Sunday. Sunday morning, I'm on, not Carlos, I'm on. Okay, and I'm thinking on the way there, oh no, there's not going to even be enough people that are going to show up to fill up the front two rows. And this is going to be embarrassing. And I got there and my expectations were high because there wasn't enough people to fill up the front row, much less the front two rows. And I went over into the side of the platform and I sat down and Geneva's running interference with the police. And I'm thinking, you know, Lord, why must I have to go through this? Why? This is humiliating. I don't want to stand up on this giant platform and look at this seat of empty chairs and minister to, like, you know, 30 people in the midst of 5,000 chairs. Lord! You hear the cry of my heart where I'm just being broken before him and wanting his will to be done. Can you hear it?
Yes.
Can you hear that? Ain't no will being done but mine in that situation. And nothing but that ain't no brokenness there. That's nothing but pride and haughtiness and self-reliance and more for me. And the Lord spoke to me in his mercy. He didn't need to speak to me. And the wrong spirit and the wrong attitude of my life should have been enough to shut down being able to hear his voice, but his mercy is there. And he says, why are you doing this? And when he said, why are you doing this? I broke. I was busted. I started weeping. Lord, I'm doing this for you. I got up. I preached as though I was preaching to 5,000 people. It wasn't long after that, and I was preaching to close to 50,000 people in Papua New Guinea. God is going to have it his way. And you can either fight him or have him fight against you, or you can participate with his realm of existence, of what he says is good and what he says is right. When everybody around you says that is stupid, that is crazy, they're abusing you, they're using you, they're like, you're like a doormat in their life, when are you going to stand up for yourself? You say, no, I'm laying down my life for everyone. I'm not standing up for myself. I'm not going to practice protecting my kids. Huh? I heard a man of God say, a great man of God did so many wonderful things. I'm going to try to stay away from names because it's just wrong for me to do that. But because too many people know these names, that this goes out all over the United States and just so many different places in the world. And, you know, I just don't want to in any way be somehow, you know, speaking in a derogatory way against any person that is anointed of the Holy Ghost. You know, but I know a great man of God, and it was when he was still in his early days of just being, you know, a deacon in the house, minister in the house. He had an idea to go and take care of the kids and get a bunch of kids to do it together and have a kids ministry. And he went to the overseer, the archbishop, the father, what's looked at as the father, kind of like the pope, you know, in this particular denomination. And he said, "This is what I want to do." And the guy, his father, spiritual father, was over everybody. All these ministers said, "Oh, I'm good. That's a great idea. I'm 100% for that. Go and do it." And so he's going and getting it organized, and because there's many, many churches now that are going to have to participate with them because the person in authority has given his stamp of approval. And one of the pastors said, "Oh, he's only doing this because he's trying to draw attention to himself. He's trying to make himself a big man. He's ambitious," and on and on and on. Slandered him. So he goes to the head overseer, the father, spiritual father, and says, "This is what this pastor is saying." And of course, this pastor is just another man under this person's authority, under the spiritual father's authority. And the guy actually, the preacher, the pastor, had actually put it in a letter. So he was able to actually, wasn't hearsay, actually able to hand to the spiritual father, the overseer, the general overseer of this denomination, this letter. He read it for himself. And you know what he said? This particular preacher is thinking, "Well, because he's with me, he gave me the stamp of approval, he's going to go over there and he's going to read that pastor the right act. Said, you're observing, you're in the door." He said, this man was a man of God, he was wise. In the spirit, that's why he had all that he had. He said, "No." He said, "This is what I want you to do. I want you to go beg him. I want you to go beg him and plead with him to give you his permission." Come on, people. If we could just learn how to walk in humility and govern our ideas and our perspectives and our thinking and our judgments after submission one to another, being subjected, subjugated. Just somebody was listening to the Word of God and doing it. People, we're tripping up all over ourselves because we've got wrong models and we got wrong behavioral patterns that have been reinforced over and over again. And we want to start walking in the Holy Ghost and not allow them to be reinforced and say, "Listen, man, let's go ahead and just understand how to do this. Let's get on with this program. It's time for revival fire to fall upon Southern California." Amen. This is the only way it's going to happen, because we're going to cooperate with God. We're going to do it His way.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And quit being fussy. Colossians 3:12. Look there with me. Just don't forget this. Don't forget this. You're not going to be hearing the voice of the Lord. You're not going to be walking in His footstep. You're not going to be walking out His life unless you give yourself over to humility and brokenness. And that's not how you're interacting with Him. That's how you're interacting with the people around you. And it's important based upon the hierarchy of relationship. And let me tell you a little bit about the hierarchy of relationship within the framework of those people that you're rubbing shoulders with right now. Your husband and your wife is right up there at the very top. Your parents are right up there at the very top. Your children are right up there at the very top. Your brothers and sisters, your family of your own personal blood, brothers and sisters, right up there at the top. Your household of faith, your brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, right up there at the top.
Amen.
And then on top of that, you're supposed to lay down your life for the world too.
Amen.
You're laying your life down first and foremost for the household of faith. What does that look like? You're going to bear their sin and their transgression. They don't got to sit around smiling at you and constantly praising you and reaffirming to you how wonderful you are so that you can continue in relationship with them. Because this is basically about all that we've known. God, forgive us, help us. Or rather, Lord, let us be willing to allow you to help us. Oh, God. You are my God, you're all I want, you're all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Oh, God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 says, put on therefore as the elect of God. Here's what he demands. This is what we are to be endued with. This is what we're to be clothed with. This is really the same thing. It means the same thing as being endued with Christ Jesus, or being clothed with Christ Jesus, or put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And make no provision for your own human desires, to fulfill your own human desires. And I like to translate Romans 15 that way, because people get off into talking about fleshly lust. It's not just fleshly lust. It can be translated, because we then make that another category altogether. It's just simply doing your own will and living your own life. It simply means your own human desires. It doesn't need to be a category that is purely demonic and worldly. It's just simply stating, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill your own human desires, your own will, your own wants, your own dreams, your own wishes. Let God put dreams on the inside of you and vision on the inside of you and make them so huge to you that it's all that you want. But still bigger than that. Still bigger than that. It's just Him that we want. Listen, when I came to Jesus, I didn't come to Jesus to be a pastor. It wasn't even in my thoughts. In fact, it was the first thing, most foreign thing to my thoughts. It would be the last thing I wanted to be. I've had enough of pastors. That's why I left the church as a young man anyways, because of all of that mess. I came into this relationship. I called upon the name of the Lord Jesus for Him. And nothing's ever going to change, and it's going to remain Him. It's not going to be some position. Some expression. It's just going to be, oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Because it changes the landscape of what we're willing to do. It changes it from being religious to relational. Something that you have to do to something that you desperately want in your life. Put on therefore as the elect of God. Are you the elect of God? I'm the elect of God. You're the elect. You the elect.
Yes.
You the select group.
Yes.
A royal priesthood.
Yes.
A holy nation. This is how God feels about us. Everybody else maybe not feel about you this way. Maybe you don't even feel about yourself this way. This is how Father feels about us. And this is how He feels about you. Royal priesthood. A highly treasured people. A holy nation, a holiness and purity. I know this. I don't want the false models and the man-made models. I know to walk in that which is purely heavenly and divine, that which is superior to the natural or supernatural. We must walk in holiness and purity and brokenness and humility. It is chief among that which Jesus modeled for us and showed us. That is the means, the realms, the divine relationship, the product of interaction with the Most High that produces all of this outworking. God, the Holy Spirit, divides individually to each person according to His will. What you have right now is what God, the Holy Spirit, has willed, because it's all you've allowed Him to do up to
this point of the immeasurable power of God in your life, because when God begins to speak in you and through you, it will be like a fire shut up in your bone. You won't have to get anybody to motivate you and encourage you. You won't have to think it through and act it through and try to be it. It will explode out of your being. It will explode upon you. You will be unable to do anything else. I promise you. I promise you. I promise you. I'm talking about in the exploits of God. Always along the way, it is you and I saying yes or no to God based upon our willingness to cooperate with those things that He demands us to give and yield our members to, like humility. As the elect of God, He says, this is what you've got to be willing to do. Amen. This is in your category. Are you willing to do it? Are you willing to give yourself to it? Are you willing to ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come fill me with this loneliness. Means show me how to put this into action tomorrow morning with my wife. Because it's got to start at your nearest relationship. There's too many people's relationships are just another, it's just another ring of hell. It's an outward ring of hell. It's a hell. It's a constant aggravation. It's a constant grief. It's a constant burden. It's a constant torment. It's a constant argument. And they go to church. They go to church. You got to get saved there first. You got to have Jesus there first. You got to yield to God the Holy Ghost there first. And the same thing goes on with their parents, and the same thing goes on with their children, and it just reproduces itself over and over again in every relationship that they have, because it's a demon power. It's out of control, and it's got to be broken. And it's broken by simply repenting, turning back to God. It's broken by the precious blood of Jesus. It's broken by a will that says, no, I will not back down. I will not change my heart, my Amen. Mind. I am determined to follow you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Teach me to walk in humility. Amen. I'll go through whatever I have to go through.
Amen.
We lost that huge facility that we had there in the Naval Training Center, and then, you know, the next thing we know, Luce Auditorium, a big theatrical auditorium, opens up to us, and we're going to have meetings in there. Still believing God for all the things that Father prophesied concerning what He wanted to do through a church. What He wanted, He was looking for a people that He could move through. He was looking for a people that He could be glorified in the midst of them, that would honor Him to a place where He could honor them. Honoring Him and says, I'm going to stop doing my own thing. I'm just going to stop being my own way, and I'm going to get subjugated here, and I'm going to get broken here, and I'm going to get taught of God, and I'm going to want Him more than anything else. But it doesn't matter what else happens. Are you going to find me in this place of seeking Him, of crying out to Him, of knowing Him, of walking as the elect of God, as we're getting ready to read right here? And you know, preachers came around me that you just love their admiration. You love the fact that they're impressed by you and what's going on in your life. And then, you know, one preacher, a friend of mine, said, your bum always lands in the butter. Well, all of a sudden, my bum got kicked out of the Loose Auditorium. And well, I lost that place too. And I had, you know, people like Harold Braderson, who they, you know, people have called him the father of charismatic revival, Kim Clements, and, you know, all these people are dead now. Say, oh, God's given you all this property and all of this land, and it's yours, and this prophecy and that prophecy. And then, of course, when you lose it, it's because somehow you failed God, you sinned, you blew it big time. You know, that's it. This is it. This is the way it works. This is the program, you know? And now I'm on my way from the Loose Auditorium, 6 years of being in this huge facility, on my way to the Hilton on Mission Avenue. And I'm going, oh God, why me? Why must I go through such a humbling process? I still don't get it. And this is after he said, why are you doing this? This is after, I still don't get it. I get more than I had it, but I still don't get it. Why me? Lord, what's going on? Where am I failing you? And we get to this little room in the Hilton. Praise God, there were people there. Praise God, it was mostly full. It was actually full. Praise God. And the power and manifest presence of the Lord was so, remember, it was so dramatic and so powerfully revealed. I said, Lord, I'll stay in the Hilton for the rest of my life. I will stay right here. This is good. This is a good spot. Because at the end of it all, I got what I wanted. I got His manifest presence. I got His exploits. I got His favor. I got His tokens. I got that which my heart is set upon Him. Yeah, yeah, we start wanting the people. We start wanting the numbers. We start wanting the success. We want to be right there with the big, you know, all the big folks. And the Lord says, no, you can't be. Why? What about me? I know about baby activities because I'm like been the master of them. I know how they hold you back. That's why I'm talking to you about you, because we all a bunch of act-alikes. I know what you're going through. I've been there. Jesus was touched by the feeling of our infirmity. He's touched by, He knows exactly what we're going through. He knows exactly what we're up against. He knows exactly how it feels. He knows exactly what it means to be set aside, to not be in the number of the great ones. Are you with me? To be the guy that everyone's ashamed of. Oh, yeah, well, that's Mark. He's hanging out with us. We're trying to sow into his life. We're believing God for a breakthrough for him. Just ignore him. To where it doesn't even matter, that's me. That's right. I'm so glad you guys allowed me to be around. And you really mean it. You're just like, I'm just so happy to be in the number. I'll tell you right now. Because listen, what happens is when all you want, the only person you want to impress, the only person you want to gain approval is God, is Christ Jesus, is the Father. It changes the whole dynamics of you needing approval from everybody else and you being in the rat race for success and who's who, as one brother says in the charismatic zoo, who's who, or how better are you than someone else, or what is it that you have, what giftings do you, all nonsense. Nonsense, 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 please. Lord, do what you need to do because He wants to work a work in our life to prepare us unto every good work. Amen. I define Jesus like this, how that God anointed Him with the Holy Ghost who went about doing good. God anointed Him with the Holy Ghost and power. Acts 10:38, the summary of who Jesus is and what He's purposed you and me to be. How that God the Father anointed Him with the Holy Ghost and power. Why? Because He honored Father. He gave honor to Father, to just do Father's will. God, because He chose righteousness, because He chose that which is good, because He chose humility and brokenness, He chose meekness and to do the will of the Father. Father anointed Him with the oil of gladness above all everyone else. Amen. Who went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with Him. God is with us, but He wants to show the proof of it on another level. But we got to quit being so arrogant about the whole program and wanting to take all the glory unto ourselves and the fame unto ourselves and say, hey, look over here at me. A prophet of God told a dear friend of mine, and I'll just tell you who his name is because and everything about this is good, Joel Stockstill. Larry Stockstill's son, he said to him, the Lord revealed to me how Satan was able to overthrow the mighty angels that beheld the glory of God throughout the eternities of the past. He said, one day I'd been in a meeting and the Lord had anointed me with great authority over demon spirits and we cast out a number of demon spirits that day in the meeting. Some radical manifestations. And then he went into a vision after the meeting and Satan was outside of his room where he was praying, banging on the window, pointing his finger at him and saying, I'm coming in there to beat the snot out of you. And this is all in a vision. He comes in and Satan is there like a boxer, like a professional boxer and going around saying, I'm taking you down. I'm taking you down. And then all of a sudden he drops his pose of boxing and he says, wow, I said, I'm really impressed with you. You're an amazing man of God. Your integrity is unreproachable, and begins to brag on him, begins to flatter him, begins to build him up as he gives him all of these flattering statements. And then he says, you want to know how I deceived the mighty angels? And he folded himself into a big accordion. And he started singing a song, playing this music that the prophet of God said it's like no music that he ever heard. No praise had ever he had ever heard like that. The greatest and most anointed songwriters that he had ever heard write songs didn't even compare to what Satan was doing as he was praising God, the Most High God, the Sovereign, the Almighty, the Most High. Verse after verse, chorus after chorus. And he's just stunned. This is how you overthrew the angels. He's just stunned because it's going on of this high praises to the Almighty, of speaking of all of His wonderful works, of all of His goodness, all of His purity, all of His love, all of His grace, all of His mercy, declaring the majesty of all of His character. Verse after verse, chorus after chorus. And then he said right at the end, and worship me too. One little phrase. And worship me too. So much of that poises itself in the realms of any pride and any haughtiness and any self-reliance that we would allow. And God demands it to be worked out. Because He loves us so much more than anything we do. He would rather keep us small and insignificant, even though that He's given to us all the fullness of His power and authority, if all of it's going to do is destroy our soul in hell. Because we don't know how to handle it. My dad, other ministers who had mighty displays of miracles in their life, would tell me about how after somebody was on their deathbed and they're raised up and a loved one has their dying loved one who everybody says they're dead tomorrow morning is now raised up perfectly healthy making food for you, and then they come and fall down your feet and they grab your feet and they start kissing you and praising the mighty acts of God in your life. It messes with you. It messes with you. Hello. But to be so hid away in Jesus, amen. To be so hid away in Jesus, amen. To recognize it had nothing to do with you, ha ha. And I'm telling you, you might be able to say that verbally right now, but it's going to really show up how you treat the people around you, how you walk as the servant, as you the foot washing servant, how you walk subjugated to one another, whether or not you take offense, whether or not you carry unforgiveness, whether or not you're constantly at odds with somebody or even God, called condemnation or guilt. Because that's all functions in the realm of pride and self-reliance, believe me. God's calling us into a place of just surrender to Him and say, Lord, I don't know how to walk in lowliness and meekness because everybody around me is showing me just the opposite. But Holy Spirit, I'm so blessed that You've come here to be the teacher and the leader and the guide. And I thank You, Lord, that You've reproduced this inside of me. You've given me a humble and a broken and a contrite heart. Oh, hallelujah, the one that You will not despise. You gave it to me. Now, I want to learn how to hear You. I want to learn how to yield to You. I want to learn how to fight the good fight and shut down anything that would try to work in my members that I've allowed in my life or I have used or I have seen as people that I've allowed myself to be impressed by and use as a model for my life. Because that's how it works. God's helping you tonight. Amen. I'm telling you, there's people in this place that are going to rise up in this place of greatness called lowliness and meekness. And you're going to learn how to every day let God shape you. You're going to become a foot washing servant. I tell you, you're going to become somebody who's going to walk in lowliness and meekness. Hallelujah. You're not going to be self-willed. Praise God. Here's the greatness. Here's the majesty. He says, therefore, put on the majesty. Therefore, put on the splendor. Therefore, put on the glory. Therefore, put on all the beauty of Almighty God as the elect of God, holy and beloved. Here's what you are. You are the elect, the special, the holy. Hallelujah. When God's saying you holy, then you are holy.
Amen.
I don't care what anybody else's opinion about it is. Hallelujah. When God says you righteous, you are righteous. He says as the holy, as the beloved, you put on the deep compassions of mercy. You put on the deep, this word bowels, this deepness. It's the same place where the rivers come from that Jesus said, out of your innermost being, out of your belly, out of your bowels comes forth these rivers of living. The deepest part of your emotions and the deepest part of your affections, that's where the humility is. That's where God wants mercy to be, kindness to be. Come on, people. It's giving yourself over in a meeting place with God to discover this activated by the unction of the Holy Ghost. Not something that you're trying to find and you don't even know how to begin. Begin is born again. To begin is to be born again. Maybe you've fallen from grace and you need to get born again again. I don't know. Maybe that's really what it comes down to for some people. This is where it seems like they just cannot connect with the reality of this beauty and this splendor. But I'm certain that everybody in this place tonight, you can connect with this realm of divine glory. It's there. It's right at your fingertips, so to speak. You've just been grabbing handfuls of other things. Are you listening to me? It's right at your fingertips, but you've been grabbing handfuls of other things. Tonight, in the name of Jesus, you give yourself to that which is most majestic. You give yourself to that which is most important of all. You give yourself to the training camp of the Holy Spirit. You be willing to be conformed to the image of Christ. People are power hungry, and they're running after, going after unauthorized authority. It's happening all over the place. And I'm going to tell you right now, an unauthorized authority will cause a devouring fire to consume and destroy you. Ask Nadab and Abihu, who brought in unauthorized, who had walked in an unauthorized authority with unauthorized fire. And the list goes on. I don't want any unauthorized authority. I only want what Father has for me. Amen. And I'm just praising Him for it. Yeah. I'm not feeling, tonight, I hope you understand, I'm not feeling bummed out that I'm not pastoring a church of 3,000 people or even 1,000 people or even 500 people after 36 years of pastoring. In most people's opinion, that is, you know, a loser with a capital L. You really need to give up and go on and try to see if you can do something else successfully. No. I'm doing what He has required of me. I'm an unprofitable servant. I'm just blessed to be right here. I'm as happy. I'm as blessed. I'm as thankful. I can't even believe that God would honor me so much to even be allowed to do what I'm doing right now. Hallelujah. And I mean it with all of my heart. I mean it. And if there's any place in me that doesn't mean it, I want to mean it. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I don't look at it as a cross either. I look at it as an honor. Just so honored. So honored to be used by Him in any area that He would allow me. And I'm going to tell you right now, He put great big dreams on the inside of me, and they're not very dry bones laying in a valley of dry bones. And if they are tonight for you, God's asking you, can these very dry bones live? Yes. Huh? And the best thing you can say is, thou knowest. Because he will cause them to live. He'll take it. He'll take what you thought was something that's forgotten. Because look, you think about God's dream. God's purpose, God's vision for the people of Israel, and look at how they turned out. They turned out like a valley of very dry bones. And He caused His vision to live and turn into a mighty army executing His will. And He's just showing us what He'd do for us. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm a big dreamer.
Amen.
And people say, you know, I've learned, you know, I go talk, you know, if I start talking to people, Daniel will say, hey, Dad, let me talk to him. And I say, yes, right, son, you talk to them. Because I completely blow their mind. I tell them basically about this thing that I'm supposed to be telling them about A. I've told them about the universe. And he's like, and Daniel's like, Dad, you completely lose them. Because the one topic was more than they could wrap their head around. And now you went to 10 topics and it just kept getting bigger and you know it and you see it and it's real, but they don't even get Wagyu.
They can't get Kashmir, Nepal, orphans, the lost, conquering the world, taking by storm the unreached people groups. They don't even get that. Just, I'm like, yes, I got it. Because I'm a big dreamer. I'm going to dream big, man. I believe in God to use me in extraordinary ways without any ambition. It's something that He does. I don't want it for me. I want it for Him. I'm happy sitting on a horse moving cows around. Really, that's weird, isn't it? But I'm happy doing this, sitting on a horse moving cows around way up in the mountains with long hair and a big old weird beard. I'm happy with that. Just loving Jesus and serving Him. I'm doing this for Him. It's not for any other reason. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And He still lets me get on a horse and move cows around. True, He gives us the desires of our heart. Seriously, you don't. That's weird, man. Why'd you want to do that? City folks just don't get it. That's okay. Hallelujah. And I still haven't got to do one of the things that I really want to do, and I'm going to do it. I want to go hunting elk way out in the backcountry, horseback with a pack mule. And I just never have time to do it. I've never got to do it. I'm going to get it done. I got invited to come up and minister in April in Juneau, Alaska. I'm so looking forward to being with Sam Dolan. He's a great man of God. I think that what happens is a lot of these preachers go out there because they get to hunt while they preach. You know, it's like it's a hunting, paid for a hunting trip. And he says, look, you know, he said, I'm telling you, I'm inviting you at a time before bear season. I'm like, listen, I promise you, I'm not even into bear season. I don't need to go shoot a bear. I'm really just so blessed. I got plenty of places to go shoot bears. I'm just so blessed to get to come represent Jesus, to get to come press in for a move of God in your church in Juneau, Alaska. I've never been to Alaska. Praise God for that. Huh? Father wants to use you in extraordinary ways. He wants to use us in extraordinary ways. Think about it. Holy Ghost has come to take everything that belongs to Father and reveal it and transmit it to us. And we're sitting around here diddle-dallying around, playing spiritual tiddlywinks. Got to get a special anointing to even have praise sound real. Huh? Got to get a special lightning flash from heaven just to get a smile. Huh? Got to have a special supernatural power move of God just to have a little bit of joy. Ha ha. It's crazy, man. I hope you're not too embarrassed by this behavior. But tonight, to demand that it be changed. Amen. That we walk and continually walk in joy unspeakable. That we have a deep bowels of compassion. It's an inspiration. It's an unction. It just drives us forward. It's the knee-jerk reaction of our divine nature and not some human condition. Not to live as a human being. That which is born as a human being is a human being. That which is born of the Spirit of God is of the Spirit of God. Amen. Jesus made the contrast right off. He got everything perfectly categorized so that we understand who we are. Amen. That which is born as a human being is a human being. And that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. God is a Spirit. And the only way you can interact with Him and worship Him is by Spirit. And so God makes a Spirit. It's called the divine nature. It's the new creation. It's the new man. It's a heavenly realm. It's that which belongs to the Holy Ghost. It's that where Christ Jesus is in us and we are in Him.
Amen.
It's a different race.
Amen.
The day that Abraham obeyed God and stepped out with God, a race was born.
Amen.
A race was born. His blood flows through my veins tonight. His life fills me tonight. Oh, my blessed Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I loved you, Lord Jesus, it's now. Oh, Jesus, I love you.
I know thou art mine. To thee all the follies of sin I resign. My blessed Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I've loved you, Lord Jesus, it's now. My blessed Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I've loved you, Lord Jesus, it's now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved. That's us. That's me. That's you. Bowels of mercy, kindness, humility, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. It goes on. If you and I were tonight simply consecrate ourselves to being that at home with our spouse, with our children, with our parents. It's going to take some practice. There's going to be some breakthroughs. You start laying hands on people for them to be healed. I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to take some breakthrough. You start going after seeing, you know, supernatural, divine prosperity and finances breakthrough. It's going to take some persistence. There's going to be some challenges. There's going to be some hindrances. There's going to be all those old things that push all of your buttons and rings all of your bells going to come rising up. Huh? It's just that you're not going to respond to them anymore.
Amen.
You're going to learn how to just go right over here saying, amen, crying out to Him, telling the Lord, oh God, you my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. Let me just try to quickly run through just a couple of verses scripture real quickly. Proverbs 11:27. Proverbs 11:2 tells us that pride comes before a fall. Recognize as soon as you're going, you allow pride in your life, actions of pride in your life, it is going to result in you falling. It's going to result in you losing out on those things which God has blessed you with. You cannot afford it. Don't allow it. Identify it quickly and give no place to it. He says to us, he says, pride cometh, he says, when pride cometh, then comes shame. But with the lowly is wisdom. If I just stay over here in relying upon God, if I walk in brokenness, if I let Him be the leader, if I say, I don't know what to do, I don't know where to turn, I don't know what to say, oh God, I look to You to give me the guidance. I do whatever it is that You purpose me to do. Lead me, Lord. Then we begin to function in wisdom. Understand that all the exploits and the signs and the wonders and the miracles of the Old Testament is directly connected with wisdom. The spirit of wisdom in Revelation directly connects us with the exceeding greatness of His power that has been given to us by Jesus Christ. Amen. If it has been given to us and granted to us when God raised up Jesus from the dead and raised us up together with them, yeah, to walk in that wisdom.
Yes,
he says in 18:12, or I believe it's 18:12, he said, before destruction, the heart of man is haughty. Mm-hmm. Haughtiness, pride is going to bring you to shame. It's going to bring you to destruction. God in His mercy is constantly intervening. God in His mercy is constantly bringing us to repentance. God in His mercy is constantly correcting us. But we're going to have to listen to Him. We have to be willing to go all the way, not halfway, not 90%.
Amen.
100%. Say, Lord, I want Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I recognize that humility and lowliness and meekness is one of Your fruits. It's the realm of godliness and righteousness. It's a place that we're going to have. If we'll be willing to live in a place called holiness, separation unto God. And we've got to elevate it to number one, not when everything else is done, we'll get around to that. All the easy ones first. Now, this is the beginning one.
Amen.
This is the entrance one.
Amen.
The spirit of holiness is the spirit of brokenness.
Amen.
He tells us in Proverbs 29:23, a man's pride shall bring him to ruin. Shame, destruction, ruin. But honor shall uphold. So established, so that he does not fall, those who walk in humility of spirit. You decide. What is it going to be? Father's given us the insight. He's fundamentally telling us about the honor that he wants to give. He's fundamentally telling about the promotion that he wants us to give. The true riches that he wants to give to us, that he wants us to have. It's in the realms of the anointing. We're in the realms of the flow of his own grace and power and authority that we've been clothed with, that we've been endued with. We're not going to function with him until we get this. We're going to have all the results that man can give one another, and that's it. And so a man is exalted, and he makes, you know, the billions of dollars like the Bill Gates, and he makes the billions of dollars like the other folks that are all out there running their own life and doing their own thing. Listen, all flesh is as grass. All the glory of men is a flower of the field. Their days are numbered. They will come to total ruin. It doesn't matter where they stand within the framework of this life. It's the life that goes on throughout the ages to come that really matters anyways. Amen. It's not what you're doing necessarily, the greatness that you're living right now, even though God has planned something so great, it's so spectacular, it can only begin to be described by the life that Jesus lived in 3 years. But the things that are beyond this threshold of existence, as we step over into the realms of eternity, the endless ages of Almighty God, and what He's purposed us to be in Him and to do in Him, and the power and the glory of the authority that He has hinted at that will be ours, that He will vest in us and has already vested in us, is far bigger than anything we'll do in this life. Amen. It's time to get ready.
Yes.
I'm preparing for the ages.
Amen.
I'm preparing. Tomorrow is all about me getting prepared and dressed up and ready for my face-to-face meeting with the Almighty God. That's all tomorrow means. It doesn't mean anything else. It's my being prepared, my being made ready to step into that place and behold face-to-face that which even the seraphims must veil their face and not behold. And I get to look eye to eye and see him as he is, for I shall be like him. Hallelujah. You shall be like him. What a rich, beloved, having such a confidence and such a promise, we must, John says with great exclamation, purify ourselves even as he is pure.
Yes.
He's saying, make ready. That's what he says. 1 John 3:4, make ready. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we should be, but we know that when we see him, we shall behold him as he is, for we shall be like him. Every man that hath this hope purifieth himself, even as he is pure. An empowerment. What are you going to do with tomorrow? Tomorrow might be an opportunity for you to become more like a devil, more conformed to the demonic realm, to be accused by God himself, by the Spirit of the Lord, of being an adulterer and an adulteress, because you have a friendship with the world, a kinsmanship with what's going on in the world, an attraction to go in there to the casino to see what all they're doing in there, an attraction to go into the bars and to go into the ivory palaces of men and to see all their opulent living, and even worse, their disgusting depravity. When God has given us an invitation to come and behold his beauty and his glory and his splendor and be bathed in his love and his peace and his goodness and his purity. And when you begin to see it, all you want is him. We begin to become in awe of God, in awe of him, in awe. I don't want to die and go to hell, but I don't serve God because I don't want to go to hell. I serve God because he's such an amazing person.
Amen.
He's so amazing.
Amen.
He's Almighty, He's sovereign. There's no one more powerful, no one more wise, no one richer than He is, greater than He is. And He loves me, and He loves me so much. He loves me so much. He wants me to have all that He has. It's almost as though He doesn't lift His head above mine. He becomes my servant, and I don't even begin to comprehend that or understand that, but I'm telling you, a nature of God that is revealed, that though the heavens of heavens cannot contain Him, you'll find His dwelling with the broken and the lowly. That's where He's going to be. Heaven is His throne. The earth is His footstool. The heavens of heaven cannot contain Him. And will you build a house for Him? The Lord says, unto this man will I look. Those who are broken and contrite. Those who are lowly and meek. Those who walk in humility. Because that's who I am. That's where I'm at. Father, we want to know You in this place tonight. Lord, we want to honor You and serve You. We don't want to be led astray or misled or deceived and become somehow captivated by all the things that people are doing in the world. We don't want to live our lives in such misery that we think that the world, the demon activity, is having a good time. Oh, how lost could we be to think that demon activity is having a good time? Oh, Lord, we want to know You and understand the good time, the pleasures that are in Your presence. Hallelujah. Yes. The fullness of joy that is at Your right hand. Yes. I'm going to try my best to go quickly here with so many verses of Scripture. Proverbs 22:4 says, by humility and the fear of the Lord are the awe of God, are riches and honor and life. And let me just say, listen, I'm telling you, riches and honor and life all first and foremost to me have a spiritual meaning and a spiritual significance. It has to do with God's grace, God's mercy. It has to do with God's character, God's power, God's authority. All power and authority I give unto You over all the powers of darkness. You think about that. It is something amazing to think that God would give us all power and authority over all unclean spirits. But what if unclean spirits are allowed, You allow them to come and entice you to participate in that which God's wrath abides upon. You're not even beginning. You haven't even begun. Every sinner will turn out to be just like the model of sin, Satan. Satan is the supreme example of rebellion against God. And transgression, actually the word transgression is from the word rebel. He was wounded for my transgressions. He was wounded for my rebellion. He was bruised, crushed for my iniquity. He was chastised for my peace. And it's, of course, our. He was wounded for our rebellion or transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. He was chastised for our peace, but I just got to make it mine. You need to make it yours. Amen. And then make it collectively ours. It's got to be yours. You got to see it for you. It's got to be a relationship, but personal. He did it all for me. Oh, let God heal your heart tonight. Let God take away your misgivings tonight. Let Him fill you with that which alone can satisfy the soul. Because He never sends a hungry empty away empty without food. He never sends the thirsty away without drink. He satisfies our soul with heaven. Oh, the fear of the Lord, to be in honor of God and to walk in humility. And it's not only the spiritual dimension, but hold the spiritual dimension above all things, because Father has also given us many examples that we could give you tonight of where that also riches and honor and life equates out into that which you possess in this life. For all the goodness and the mercies of God, and you come into my house when we're together and it's a love festival. Praise God, because God's at the center. There's not the argument, there's not the strife, there's not the bickering, there's not the hurt. It's a love feast. It's a place of goodness. It's a place of thanksgiving. It's a place of divine grace. It's His life. It's what He gives to us. Riches. Maracito robo castilea. I look at what the Mormons have done and I say, God, if the devil could do that for them, I could just only imagine what You're going to do for me. And I'm not going to hold back. I'm going to lay hands. Somebody said, how are you going after so many things? I've got divine strength and I got vision to the full. And God, I'm praying that I get a bigger vision still. Hallelujah. I'm prophesying over every business that I'm a part of, and that I'm decreeing things over every business that I've started and every business that I'm a part of. Some of the business that I started, it looked like they failed. No, they were just put on hold for a little while. They're about to explode later on. Meanwhile, I'm moving on with other things. Hallelujah. And watching God bless it, I want you to get in on it too. It's, where is it found? It's found over in this place of living its life out with God, because He dreams big. He sees big. He plans big. He don't have small stuff. Look at His universe.
Amen.
And I believe that every day He's creating. I believe the expanse of the universe, though it's infinite right now, there is no outward envelope at all. There's no outer envelope. He's still creating more vastness to the infinite space of the universe that's already existing. And He's creating in me.
Yes.
And I want Him to create fully.
Yes.
And He wants to create in you. He's creating in you. Hallelujah. Hambora stepa. He creates in you a song that has never been sung before, because you've never been there to sing it. It's never come out of the expression of your heart. It's never been before, even though the words may have been there before. Maybe the tune, maybe the chord progression was there before. It's never existed because it never came out of you before. And that's just the light side of what He creates. And we're not leaving anybody out who doesn't sing. Because there are other expressions and praise that's there. That's never been uttered, never been created before, because it's never had your voice. It's never had your affection. It's never had your heart. Yours is unique, though, where there's so many similarities between us all, created in the image and likeness of God. There's a uniqueness that stands out before the Lord as something that without you doesn't exist. Your praise in the church is so important. Your willingness to yield to the Holy Ghost, so the Spirit of the living God can be expressed to you, is so essential to that which God demands to have in His church. And you've got to step up to the dream that He has dreamed for you, the vision that He has cast for you, the life and the opportunity that He's given to you. You can't sit there like you're redundant and like you don't matter, because all that is a lie of condemnation propagated by the pride and arrogance of a demonic realm. The lowly are going to serve the Master and lay their life down that others might be edified and built up. That's what Papa showed us to do in His only begotten Son. That sonship is what it looks like. That sonship. Psalms 138:6, though the Lord be high, the Most High, El Elyon, God, Elyon, God, the Most High. Though He be high, yet hath He respect unto the lowly. Listen to Mary. Look at what God has done. He has regarded the lowly estate of His handmaiden. He has brought down the mighty in their arrogance and exalted those of low degree. Listen to her. Listen to her as she magnifies the Lord. As the Spirit of the Lord begins to express through her. I mean, I'm telling you right now, you're talking about getting filled with the glory of God. As soon as you get impregnated with Jesus, I'm telling you right now, you have been touched like nobody else has ever been touched before. Woo! Can you? I can't imagine. There's no way. The life of God was just born on the inside of you as the Holy Ghost overshadowed you. Listen to what she says. Listen to the utterance of what she says. It's so valid. It's so important. It really breaks down and pares down the reality of life in God. It pairs down for us that which God blesses, that which He's ordained, and that which He's fashioned, and that which He's purposed, and that which He rejects. Listen to it. Go read it tonight before you go to bed. Listen to Mary. She says, "Be it unto me according to thy word." Oh, my. I remember the first time that I heard that by the Spirit of the Lord. And suddenly it wasn't what Mary said, but now it's what I say. And all these unspeakable things and all these glorious things that Father has given to me. Suddenly I'm not arguing with them anymore and saying, how can this thing be? But I say, be it unto me according to your word. This is what you've made me. This is what you purposed me. This is what you fashioned me to be. I agree with it.
Yes.
Though the Lord be high, yet hath he respect unto the lowly. But the proud, he knows far off. They're distant from him. God so loved the world, he so loves them. He gave his only begotten son, but they're distant from him. And he's calling them to forsake their way, to forsake their unrighteousness, to forsake their manner of living, to forsake their likeness of the demonic, to come out of darkness into light.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Proverbs 3:34, surely he scorneth the scorners. Surely he sets his reproof against the reprovers, or his boast against the boasters. Because this word actually could be translated just pride. He's prideful with the prideful. As it were, he comes to fight against the pride, the proud. But once again, it's the same as we read actually in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5. But he gives grace to the lowly. Matthew 11, 29. You've been hearing me repeat it all night. Here it is. You weary, you shamed, you downcast, you heavy laden, you afflicted, you destroyed. Come and learn of me. Come be conformed to the image. Holy Ghost has come here to teach us to live the life of Jesus. Somebody says, what is sanctification? It's simply this. It's allowing the Holy Spirit to produce the life of Jesus in you. It's you being willing to be set apart to the Holy Ghost so he can produce and mature and grow you into all the expressions of our Lord and our Savior, Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Where does this begin? You going saying sorry to the people that you've offended, that's your worst enemy? You going over to the person that you dislike the most and has done you the most damage with a bucket of water and say, can I please wash your feet? And they're going to look at you like you completely lost your mind. And you have. You've taken on the mind of Jesus.
Amen.
Those that perhaps somehow you've hurt because they hurt you, or they somehow messed with your stuff, and now you're going to go and you're going to bless them and give them your stuff. And if they ask you your coat, you didn't give them your coat, so you can go take them all your clothes. You got to give them your cloak also. And quit acting like that God's on your side as you stand up for yourself. Because you're not going to find that in the Word of God or His commission or His command. He's on your side because you're going to go lay down your life for them and deny yourself. He didn't call you to stand up for yourself, stand up for your rights, fight for your own whatever. Because you can sit around and read about this, and you can study, and you can say yes, and you can take perfect notes, but that doesn't amount to nothing. As the country man said, that don't amount to a hill of beans. Because that hill of beans isn't worth much. It's what you're going to do when you suddenly choke down, as it were. And it shouldn't have to be too much choking down. Your pride. And you go say, I'm sorry. I've been blaming you for all my misery. And it's really, I'm the one to blame. Now you must confront your unlikeness to God if you've allowed it. You eat enough humble pie and you won't want any more. You won't make any more. You eat enough crow and you won't shoot any more. Crow's a bitter dish. There's many of you, I could actually tell you by the Spirit right now what you needed to do. But because I can hear it in the Holy Ghost, you can hear it too. And maybe some of you are saying, no, I rebuke that, I rebuke that. That ain't God. No, that is God. It is God. If it looks like that you're going to go to a cross and die for the people that are guilty and you're innocent, that is exactly the Holy Ghost. That is exactly the Holy Ghost. That was God, the Holy Ghost, that you're rebuking as the devil. Because that's where riches and honor and life is. That's where God suddenly becomes the one who oversees all that you have. He becomes your provider, your protector. He becomes your defender. You know, I feel sorry for my enemies. I'm going to pray for them. I feel so sorry for them. I feel sorry for them. Honestly, if somebody starts doing damage to me, I'm just like, I feel sorry for them. Because I'm telling you right now, my Father is very protective of me. And so I started interceding, Lord, do not lay this to their charge. They have no idea what they're doing. It's a man thing. You're very well acquainted with the man thing. Lord, they do not understand. Lord, I intercede for them. Lord, lay it not to their charge. Father, cause me to be more affectionate. Cause me to be more loving. Cause me to be easier to get along with. Because Father is the defender of all such.
Yes.
Who put their trust in Him. I don't need to defend myself. You defend yourself, you're on your own. You need to provide yourself for your. You provide for yourself, you're on your own. I don't provide for myself. I used to provide for myself. It was a miserable situation. Now Father provides for me. That doesn't mean I sit home. I'm more busy than I've ever been in my life. I told Aunt last year, I said, we're slowing down this year, baby. We're getting older. We need to pace ourselves. People are encouraging me, slow down, pace yourself. And I said, we're going to slow down more this year. At the end of the year, she said, we ran harder this year than we've run in our entire lives. So now for her, we're going to slow down as code for we're speeding up. This year, I really put it into place because the Lord was dealing with me about it. So, you know, we're making our calendar. We're off to Indiana for meetings in Indiana. Is a week next week, week after next. And I said, and then we were going to be heading out to Oregon the week after next. I said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to stay in San Diego. Because that's the way I've always been. Okay, as soon as we get back, we're flying in on Sunday afternoon, preach Sunday night, fly out Monday morning. That's not slowing down. That's not pacing yourself. Hello, is this what Father wants you to do? So it's just like people were always in this situation where we're going to have to let God the Holy Ghost speak to us as we're going out conquering the world without any ambition and making ourselves really overly busy. But Father's our provider. He's our protector. He's our keeper. He's a defender. We have no lack because He's our shepherd. If you're lacking, it's where you're going off in your own route, your own road. Look, somebody's got to lead you. Who's it going to be? And if you're going to let God the Holy Ghost lead you, it's going to look just like what He described Jesus to be, what He's described in His Word. And if it's not that, you're leading. You're leading. And then they're going to work out for you. So tonight, in the name of Jesus, I want you to be that much more, says the Lord, dedicated to the things that only the Holy Ghost can produce inside of your life. By simply saying, okay, Lord, it doesn't matter how hard it is. It doesn't matter how ugly it looks. It doesn't matter. You know. And I was preaching this the other night. What was it? It was 2016 when we did New Year's Eve service. And I said, we're not carrying anything from 2016 into 2017. And as soon as I said that, the Lord reminded me of a person who had some problems with me. And then, of course, I in turn had some problems with them, always self-justified. So I immediately had to get on the phone and get things right. I immediately had to send out a text message, an email, a message to everybody out there that could possibly have any problems with me, telling them that I am praying for them and believing God's blessings and best upon them and promotion for them like they've never even imagined. In Jesus' name, I love you so much. I want to serve you in any way I can. Come on. Because if you don't do it, if you don't strike when the iron's hot, you can't mold that thing. If you're going to wait till it cools off, it ain't going to do any bending. It's going to be the same old straight thing it was before, or old crooked thing that it was before. Huh. Father, we just thank you that you minister to us tonight, that you search our heart, that you help us to understand these areas of our life that have been in the way. We pray, Father, in Jesus' name, that tonight they're moved out of the way. We quit walking around being our own champion and never maturing and never growing and never walking into that which you've commanded us to have, because we're always doing it our own way and saying that we're right with you and acting like you, the one who inspired it. Jesus. Boros de Vitalana Makupanasi. You start looking at how you can lay your life down for the household of faith. Start making yourself some notes tonight. Those will be the most important notes for you to take, not necessarily the verses of Scripture, but the notes of how you're going to apply the Word of God. How you're going to start laying your life down for the brethren. How you're going to start serving the household of faith. Hallelujah. How you're going to start laying your life down for the world because it's redemptive. How you're going to start loving when you're hated. How you're going to start blessing when you're persecuted. How you're going to start bearing the responsibility of others' transgressions even though you're innocent and let them go free. I've discovered over and over again you're not going to restore a relationship by rejecting people for their wrongdoing. You restore a relationship by hugging them and letting their wrongdoing go. And don't interact with them on the basis of their wrongdoing. Because that's how Father shows us. He doesn't interact with us on the basis of our wrongdoing, but on the basis of His love and His mercy and His affection towards us. Will you be like your Heavenly Father?
Yes.
Everybody stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. I did tell you, I just feel breakthrough in the place. There's such liberty when you don't have all the pressure of pride and arrogance and self-promotion in your life. You can sing like a crow con and think it just sounds beautiful. It just does away with all of the impositions of self-consciousness, because it doesn't even matter anymore. Of course, you're going to be quiet because you don't want to ruin anybody else's good time. Oh, yes. Doesn't it work that way? You're mindful of everybody around you. You're just mindful. You're shut in with God, the secret place, but you're mindful of everybody else around you. Oh God, I want to serve them. I want to make sure that the person that's in front of me or behind me is not being distracted by something that I'm doing, because I want to see them get the breakthrough with you and walk with you in the high places that you've ordained. I don't want to sit here being consumed with my own self-interest, meanwhile a major distraction to everyone around me. An uncaring isolate. Father, forgive us for every time we've been that, having no sensitivity to the needs of other people. Lord, forgive us so much. Thank you for your mercy. And Holy Spirit, we thank you that you empower us not to be that way. I'm going to tell you, one of the reasons that I ask people to go around and hug everybody and tell them that you love them is because you need to do that. Because it breaks you out of your issues. After a while, you'll start hugging everybody. You'll start telling everybody that you love them. You'll start becoming as wonderful and gracious and as friendly and as outgoing as Allie. Because she is, and you know it. Hallelujah. And it's a model of who God is. And when I see models of who God is, I say, that's what I want to be like. Amen. I'm going to imitate that. I'm not going to sit over here and be satisfied with my whatever that people call coolness. Yeah, it's real cool. It's on the level of cold. It's somewhere between, so cool is somewhere between cold and lukewarm. That's coolness. I'm going to be red hot. I'm going to be like God. Look around and I look at people. I watch people. Watch them. When you see the divine nature, go for it. When you see somebody sad and sorrowful and depressed, and their songs sound like there's a deep agony, does that remind you of God the Holy Ghost? When you see somebody joyful and happy, does that look like God? Rejoicing. I mean, think about it. This is not hard. You don't have to be a genius to get this. This is real simple stuff. Happy God, sad devil. Loving God, hating devil. Brokenness, humility, God. Pride, arrogancy, devil. If things aren't going the way that you want them to go, good. And you need to change that and start having things go the way that Father wants them to go. And start recognizing that you're receiving what you're willing to participate with God in. And tonight, go all the way to say, Father, I'm going to fully participate with you. I'm going to quit doing it my own way and acting like I'm living a consecrated life. He loves us so much. He's so long-suffering. He is. I'm like, every time the Lord is always, in pastoring, every time I think that, wow, Lord, how do you deal with this? And he's just telling me, he tells me how much he loves the person. One day I was dealing with some things, and I said, Lord, how can it be possible that after such a long time, these people are older than you, and how can they still be doing this? How can they still be behaving this way? And the Spirit of the Lord said, you're seeing it wrong. He said, let me show you how I see it. And I saw the people as a little baby the Father was affectionate and caring towards. And I just totally disarmed. Oh, God. I'm so sorry. I was seeing them as an adult. I was expecting things of them that they had no ability to even do. And there you are just looking at them as a little baby with affection and tenderness. I'd rather be being viewed by the Father as a little baby with affection and tenderness than nothing at all. You know, I want to grow up. Amen. I don't want the Lord to give me a vision of who I am in Him, and there's just like this little baby, he's just affectionate and loving towards. I want to do something for Father. Come on. I mean, come on. The idea of I write unto you young men because you are strong and you've overcome Satan at every point. I want to think that of myself. Strong, the word of God abides in you and you defeated Satan at every point. I want to think that of myself, but there's got to be some proof in thinking of that. Otherwise, it's an imagination. It's fictional. Because I want that so much, I'm going to do that. I'm going to say, okay, Father, I'm going to do that. And I'm looking for your strength and your power and your ability to do it. I'm going to do this. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And much of that is really on the level, not as so much as what you think at first glance. It's really on the level of walking in humility and brokenness. Because when you walk there, in humility and brokenness, when you're willing to serve the household of God and lay down your life for God's people, everything else just flows naturally. The love, the mercy, the forgiveness, the relationship. Father loves it. Father loves. I'm telling you, gets so excited by seeing you and I treated wrongfully and take it patiently. He goes, that's my boy. That's what he says. Peter said it like this. He said, it's praiseworthy. It's praiseworthy of God. It's where God starts praising it. That's my child. That's my son. That's my daughter. That's us. That's a family member. That's the correct representation right there. He goes around bragging. That's praiseworthy. God goes around bragging on you. Look at him. Look at her. She's being treated wrong. She never did anything wrong. She's been treated as though she did. And she's taking it patiently and graciously. Not defending herself. Not coming in and, you know, guilty with an excuse. Or saying, I never did it. I got to champion my own idea. I got to set the record straight. Just leave it. Just leave it. One of the things that the Satan has fought me so hard on is that he's tried over and again to break relationships that I've had with other ministers, for become best friends with people, and then ministers, and then people be used by the demonic realm, go and say, spread lies, things that I didn't say, didn't do. And every time I went to just defend myself and straighten out, the Lord said, shh. Close my mouth. Leave it. And it becomes easy for us to do when we've given our spirit over to His, the rule of the Holy Spirit. And that is a very practical application in the worship, in our praise, in our responses to the things that go on in our life when nobody else sees it. Huh? If there's anyone in this place that knows the raw me, the messed up hair, raw me, it's my wife. And she loves me. And I say this, for every one of us in here, that is an example of Father's love for us. This love that is a provision for a multitude of sin. Huh? He's good. We're set. Now unto Him who loved us. Hallelujah. And washed us from our sins in His own blood. Unto Him. Husbands, kiss your wife right now. Tell them you're going to serve them more. Tell them you're going to lay your life down for them. Because I'm going to tell you right now, it's a big deal to pops. It's a big deal. Preacher called me up one day and said, man, my wife is so unruly, she didn't do anything I say. I said, are you serving her? Well, what do you mean? Of course I am. I said, can I talk with her? Basically. Yeah, right. I said to a real meek woman here the other night, I said, is your husband taking really good care of you? She said, yes. I said, would you tell me if he wasn't? She said, no. More responsibility on the guy's head then to get it right. Come walk over here in this place of humility. You won't have unforgiveness. You won't be victim to Satan's primary number one attack against God's people, which is the spirit of offense. You'll come to understand that God expects you really even to obey those who have authority over you even when they're wrong. When you believe they're wrong, I should say. Not when they're wrong, but when you believe they're wrong. As you are going to have many opportunities for that for the rest of your life. Just prepare yourself. Prepare yourself right now. And in the midst of this, we find ourselves just being launched out into God's exploits and signs and wonders and miracles and the flow of the Holy Ghost and the gifts of the Spirit of God at work and everything that we have being blessed and being fruitful. God wants it to be fruitful. Everything about our life to be fruitful, to abound with fruit, fruits of the Spirit, fruits of His blessings, fruits of His grace and of His life. Tonight, I want you to be prepared to do two things with me. I want to receive an offering for the one of the most credible ministries that I know of in terms of ministering to the untouchables in India. If you want a radical, rough, tough ministry in India, you start ministry to the untouchables. It's part of the caste system. It's the lowest people in the caste system that the government doesn't even pay attention to. Not only do they minister to the untouchables, they have an orphanage, they take care of the old folks. When I went there and did Kate and I and Ann and Ruth Anna, when we were all there and they set up a meeting for us, a little crusade for us, they wouldn't let me pay for anything. They said, look, we want to honor you. You got here. We want to pay for all this. And they... You know, they really don't have much finances. And then, of course, as I told you before, India's economy is in crisis. They pulled the 500 rupee and the $1,000 rupee bills. And you couldn't, like, they canceled them. And you couldn't take all your 500 rupees and your 1,000 rupee bills and go trade them in for, like, you know, 1 rupee bills or 20 rupee bills, whatever. Because, no, they're canceled. They're no value. Well, all I have is 500s and 1,000s. That means you have no money. You should have had some 20s. You should have had some 10,000s. Pretty crazy, huh? Get ready, people. When people start saying peace and safety, believe me, sudden destruction comes. Get ready, people. But at any rate, right now we have the power and the privilege and the ability to bless them. And I believe I told you that we were going to receive an offering for them once a month at the end of the month. And so I want you to do two things tonight. I want you to not forsake your tithe to the church and to the ministry, because we've got things that we're going to continue to go on doing here. And, you know, Father's made us responsible for the local church, for planting churches, for evangelizing the churches of America, revival in America, and for international crusades, and for taking care of the orphans and the widows, home and abroad. And so you just participate, because if you do it, if you obey God and you do it in the realms of faith, God is going to give you supernatural provision. How many of you can raise your hand and say, I have had supernatural provision in the last month? Raise your hand. Good. And I promise you, maybe you couldn't raise your hand right now. That's a lot of testimonies to be going through right there, just right there. The reality of it is, you be faithful, and Father is going to bless you. And reality of it is, too, there's an examination going on, and we don't see the kind of results that they're supposed to be seeing in those things that we do in relationship with the Lord. We recognize there's some things that need to be corrected about our attitude and about the way that we're giving or the way that we're obeying. And we just let the Lord examine us and correct us, and it's for our benefit so that we can step into the blessing and the fruit of it. Because I'm telling you right now, believe me, it is a wonderful thing to not only step into divine health, but to step into divine supernatural provision. Wow. Wow. It's amazing. You walk into a place and you get $14,000 doors for $6,000. It's amazing. And on it goes. So I want you to prepare two offerings. One for India. Here's the one thing that I wanted to do. I never wanted to do and build another orphanage. You don't need to build other orphanages. You do not need to build more old people's homes. There are so many right now that are legitimate and good. They need to be taken care of. And when you begin to take care of them, you're allowed to minister into them and you're allowed to help them make adjustments that need to be adjusted in their in the way that they preach, the way that they minister, the way they function, the way they operate. Wow, there's hundreds of thousands of orphanages right now. And you know, somebody said, oh, I went and built an orphanage. And you know, my first reaction is, I bet it doesn't even exist. How long ago was it? About a year. I bet it doesn't even exist anymore. You're right. How did you know? Because there's a lot that goes into that. Let's get smart about this. The Lord has blessed us with a network of orphanages that is just, it is amazing. And I want to be able to touch every one of them. And that's a lot of finances. And Father says, I'm looking for somebody to give that kind of money to. I actually own it all. Can anybody smile about that in here? My wife is. I own it. But Papa says, I own it all, so am I. I can turn the grains of dirt in your backyard all into diamonds. No problem. I mean, you know, he's the treasures that he has, the riches that he has, they're immense. The earth is his. I mean, this is the dimension in which he's laid up the wealth of the wicked for the righteous. And the righteous are going to be taking care of the poor. They're going to be taking care of the orphans. And the righteous are going to be taking care of the widows in affliction. The righteous aren't going to be sitting around going, I'm waiting till I have some more finances to be able to do that. Right now, my food budget is increased. Or whatever, you know. I need more of this, I need more of that. No. Papa has told us to take care of the poor.
Yes.
And the needy.
Yes.
And the orphans.
Yes.
And the widows.
Yes.
And it's not like we haven't been doing it. It's just that the Lord laid on my heart at the end of last year to partner with Naveen. Naveen didn't ask me. He just said, listen, I want you, you know, he calls me Baba, but he said, I want you to pray for me, because here's what's happened. We 70% of, I think it was 70%, it was 70 or 80% of our finances have been taken away. They created, which is beautiful, in moving in faith, they created everything that they're doing on the ground in India. And Porridge in India, all self-supported. They did not receive finances from the United States. They weren't receiving finances from America. They were doing it all within the house. And we've lost 70, 80% of our finances because of the economic conditions of India. And I said, I want you to tell me what that means in terms of what your budget looks like. What does it mean in terms of rupees? What does it mean in terms of US dollars? And he did. He turned that right back around. And I looked at it and I said, Lord, I want to participate with making up the difference here. Because what does that mean? That means they're going out and feeding the untouchables. No one else is going. Government will give everybody food subsidies, but not the untouchables. They'll give everybody education help, but not the untouchables. They're an outcast. And they've gone out. They built a church to go out there. They take food. And now they're going, okay, now I'm having to decide, are we going to feed the orphans or are we going to feed the untouchables? And I don't want to have to decide that. You know what you and I are going to get to do? You're going to get to go home tonight in your plush little house. And you're not going to have to live in the kind of conditions that they are living in to minister to the untouchables. And you're going to be able to send your finances, and it's going to go, as it were, your hands going to hand to the untouchable people's food. That then they immediately say, why are you caring for me like this? And you know what? The Hindus don't even want the untouchables. Did you know that? They don't even want, you can't even, you knew that? You can't, untouchable, you can't come in a Hindu temple. They don't even want you around. You know how many, hundreds of thousands of souls that is to bring into the kingdom? Nobody wants them. We go feed them, guess what? There's souls by the hundreds of thousands. Come on. I mean, that's what we need to be doing with our finances. Amen. And so once a month, at the end of every month, we're going to do this. It's not that we're going to stop taking care of other orphanages and other ministries that we're involved in. And maybe I don't announce it enough, but we give a significant portion, don't we, of our finances that we come in. And we need to make that more visible to ministries overseas, to ministries, significant ministries to the poor. And that's where you're going to get blessed. I promise you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So, abiding place. Thank you so much for participating with the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. I promise you, Father's affection and His love is upon this ministry. This ministry lives before Him. Yes. It shines before Him. Yes. It's something that He is blessed by. Hallelujah. He loves us dearly. I know this. I pull up in front of the abiding place every time and I say, Lord, bless the abiding place. Let it be 10,000 times more. Amen. You know, if you're not careful, you'll listen to the lies of the enemy and you'll start saying things that lies of the enemy be repeated out of your mouth. What people, what the enemy says would try to say about the abiding place. Don't you do that. I do that. You speak what God the Holy Ghost is saying about the
Amen.
Ministry.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You do that, right? Amen. You do that?
Amen.
You're going to do that more?
Yes.
Amen. We'll come worship the Lord with your giving. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Find a bunch of people around you. Tell them that you love them and that you're never going to be the same.
Amen.
You're going to do it differently from here on in. You're going to follow the Holy Ghost. You're going to be led by Him, yes. Moved by Him, instructed by Him, kept by Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If there's anybody in this place tonight, you need a job. You need a job. You don't have the finances that you need coming in to your household to take care of your household needs. I want you to come. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray a blessing of God upon your life. And I expect tonight is going to be your night to receive what Father has purposed to give you and the blessings that He has for you. So if there's anybody in this place, you don't have a job or you don't have finances coming in to meet your household needs, I want to hook up with you in faith tonight that that's going to be changed. And if you're watching me by the web right now or by the YouTube, you can do the same thing. Just agree with me right now because I'm telling you, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command provision to come in your life. I command wisdom to come into your life. Right now, you understand the things that have been blocking you out, the things that have come as a thief, as a killer, as a stealer, as a destroyer of the blessings of God, and you don't allow it anymore. I curse the devourer right now. I rebuke the devourer right now because God rebukes the devourer for His namesake, and I command a blessing on you that you take a hold of by the grace of God, a bountiful provision, a bountiful supply, that you're going to learn how to do things right in the name of Jesus, that doors of opportunity will be opened unto you, that things will be in order in your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.